This broadcast, presented by Squirtle and its partner schools, is not to be reproduced or retransmitted in any form. The content and descriptions on the platform may not be disseminated without the written consent of Squirtle and its partner schools. The thoughts and opinions shared on Squirtle's platform are those of the individual and do not necessarily reflect the views of the organization or its partners. Squirtle does not tolerate or condone hateful, bigoted, or divisive content. We want to thank our schools, advertisers, and individuals that have joined with us in our mission to build community around the local school. This broadcast, presented by Squirtle and its partner schools, is not to be reproduced or retransmitted in any form. The content and descriptions on the platform may not...
And new tanks are always on the vans ready to go. We offer free estimates on all jobs with financing options available. We match manufacturer's warranty for all newly replaced water heaters. We'll get your water heater back up and running as fast as possible so you don't have to put your life on hold waiting for service. Give us a call today, 405-844-TANK. That's 405-844-8265. Go Wildcats!
Presenting Regatta Ranch, located within the Cashion School District and offering homebuyers the experience of small-town charm with the modern world of shopping, dining, and healthcare just minutes away. Situated east of Highway 74, Regatta Ranch boasts one-acre home site with privacy and ample space to retire or raise a family.
To build your next home from the ground up or to inquire about new properties currently for sale, contact Brandon or Shannon Potter with Iron Creek Homes and C7 Realty.
Find your forever home at Regatta Ranch.
And go Wildcats!
For 31 years and counting, Community State Bank has taken great pride in being your hometown bank. With branches located in Cashion, Dover, and Hennessy, CSB strives to reflect the small-town hospitality these communities are known for. Our friendly staff is here to serve you and provide one of the best banking experiences around, equipping our customers with the latest in banking technology combined with a personal, down-home relationship. Come into one of our local branches or visit us at www.mycsb.com. Community State Bank. Small town banking. The way it should be. Member FDIC.
All right. Welcome to another night of Cashion Wildcat football live here from Cashion, Oklahoma, where the Cashion Wildcats 3-4 taking on the Woodward Boomers 0-7. It's Thursday night edition of Cashion Wildcats TV tonight. I'm Neiman Abavi, Chris Gibson, and Drew Baker joining us here at Maxson Field in the beautiful press box. Guess who's back? Back again. Drew Baker's back. We appreciate you, friend. We appreciate you guys joining us here as the Cashion Wildcats looking to rebound off of that very tough loss in district to Christian Heritage on the road last week and taking on a 4A Woodward Boomers. Whoever thought, never saw this on the on the card, but Wildcat set here at Maxson Field. Chris and Drew, welcome, and I think that it's I guess the theme maybe for this week is refresh and reset, right?
Yep,
definitely. You know, after the game last week, you know, there's been a lot of talk of what happened in that game last week.
Who's been talking?
But you know what? It doesn't matter now. Yep. You got to move on. I've talked to the coaches, and they're saying, hey, that was our fault. We should have had the boys better prepared. We should have had a better game plan. Coach Shaq put it squarely on his own shoulders and said, you know, you got to take all of that out of it and say, we missed extra points. We did, you know, we had our own mistakes that if we would have taken care of. And that's exactly what you want a good coach to say is, you know, you don't want to blame anything else that goes on. Even though all the fans, everybody else can say all they want, that coach is going to say, I'll have them better prepared the next time. And now it's time to move on. And the coaches know exactly what they need to do. The players know exactly what they need to do to make the playoffs. And they're ready to come out here and get right against the Boomers and be ready to roll into those last two district games.
Yeah, Drew, you were watching from pay dirt. I mean, you had a chance to follow along, you know, from the standpoint as a former player here, having, you know, been coached by Coach Shaq and Coach Wood and a bunch. I mean, after, you know, we've had a couple of just a tough loss. You know, what's usually kind of the mentality that week in practice as you think about these guys this week?
Usually, I mean, whatever day they watch film, when we were in high school, it was we watched film on Sunday after we lifted, and then we'd go in there and we'd watch film, we'd, you know, get our butt chewings or congratulations for whatever may or may not have happened in the game, and then at the end of it, he'd turn the film off, and he'd be like, the two things that matter, the score at the end of the game, and he said, and then the score at the end of the next game. So you can't, yes, it sucks, you know, we lost last week to CHA, but at the same time, he's not going to dwell on that, and this week, you know, prepare for Woodward.
Yeah.
which since Woodward's not, you know, a district game, they're Class 4A, and they're pretty big size, like Crescent and Hinton. I think we'll use that as an opportunity to kind of work and prepare for them. This is the last two district games they got to play.
Absolutely. You know, it's kind of very similar to what happened earlier. We had that tough loss to Minco, came back, had that game against Western Heights out of district, won it, came back and had that win against Watonga. So maybe it's kind of maybe a similar deal here where the Wildcats take on a 4A team and the Woodward Broomers, and they're every bit of 4A. I know their record's 0-7, but they have the size and everything. They got about, you know, and their football team, I think they got more people in the entire school here. But the idea is that, you know, you regroup, you figure it out, and then you get ready for hitting. Chris, I know that we've got district. You've got that district table up. You know, I guess this might be a good time to kind of talk about it a little bit before we break down the Woodward Boomers and led by Coach Rick Luton. But the idea here is A3 is still wide open. You know, surprise, look at their Crescent up 3-0 in district, undefeated. They're ranked, they're doing well. Christian Heritage has had two very, very close wins that have propelled them. They've been on the good side of those 50-50 situations to be at 3-1, and then there's Minco at 2-1, and there's Cashion 1-2, not last place, it feels like it, but not in last place, and in essence really have a chance to kind of control their own destiny. Chris, from your perspective, I mean, what do you see here from District A3?
I mean, I know what Coach Shackford's saying. Go win the next two games. We're in the playoffs. It don't matter.
Right.
But as a fan and as us breaking it down, you know, we look at it and say, if Minco beats Hinton this week and we go out and beat Hinton next week, we're in no matter what.
Yeah.
If Minco gets beat by Hinton, we're pretty much, you have to win both of the next two games if you're the Cashion Wildcats to make it into the playoffs. And so, really, I guarantee you those coaches are not telling them, let's see what Minco and Hinton do tonight before we really – they're saying, guys, we lost that game against CHA last week. Who cares how it happened? We lost it. Now we got to go win. Let's go win the next two and get ready to roll into the playoffs with some momentum.
Yeah, I love it. I love it. Drew, from your perspective –
yeah, I mean, really just kind of like what Chris said. Obviously, you know, Coach Shaq's mindset's going to be, hey, you know, let's just go out and win the next two games, obviously, including tonight. I mean, just because tonight we're playing 4A Woodward doesn't mean he doesn't want to go out and win this game. So I just think it's always fun as a fan. I'm sure Lane's already got it broke down in 20 different ways how it could all shake out as far as districts go. But it just kind of
He's got the points broken down.
So just at this time of the year, it just kind of gets like, okay, you know, you really got to be playing your best football these last couple weeks.
Yeah, you know, that's one of the gifts of being up here in the press box is you get that inside. You talked about Lane. That's so funny. It's just like these are things that don't even come to my mind. But, you know, we have a few folks here in Cashion that break down. Chad Tischer's one of those when it comes to basketball. Break down the entire situation. Mike Shaline with baseball and softball. He'll tell you where tiebreaker's at and what's going on.
Well, it was funny. I was talking to some people this week, and they were like, we either need to get second district, first, or fourth. We don't want to be third because if we're third, we match up with, like, Ringling or so they had it broke down
the best
to where we needed to finish in district if we weren't going to win first. And I was just like, guys, we just got to make it in the playoffs and then go play whoever.
The best story on that district breaking down, I think it was our junior year maybe in high school, and we looked at the playoff brackets and it was like, okay, we don't want to be in second place. We either need to be first or third. And there was this whole talk all week of, you know, maybe giving starters a rest. And then at the end of the week, Shaq just came in and was like, if we're going to win, we might as well be good enough to beat anybody. So we're just going to go out and play it.
And I think that was the place to land. You know, typically when people try to game the system, they get gamed.
Yeah.
And so I remember that. And, you know, I think I fell on the side to say, just go play and see what happens. And, you know, we had a very tough, close game to Afton in the second round up there.
I think that year Afton won the state championship
and they ended
that
up
year.
Winning the state championship, right? Exactly. So, anyway, well, we appreciate you guys joining us here on Cashion Wildcats Television. We've got some great football sponsors for sure that we want to make sure and highlight. We do that every single week. You know, from a standpoint of the Booster Club, it's a little bit different this year. It used to be all sports. Now it's broken up by each sport. And God bless all these fantastic folks, all of our fantastic platinum sponsors, gold and silver, making sure that we're looking good, playing sharp, and have the great facilities. You know, it does mean something when you can put a maroon paw out in the field, or when you can honor the Rough Riders and have a Rough Rider, version of uniforms. And that doesn't happen without these great and fantastic sponsors. Really appreciate them for sure. And, of course, all of our fantastic sponsors on the Scordle. You'll see them in the bottom right corner. throughout the season at every event in terms of their support and help making sure that this is a free service to all of you. And we may have some folks from Woodward joining us tonight. I don't know if they're a part of the Squirtle family, but if you're watching from Squirtle, we appreciate, or from Woodward.
I don't know why they wouldn't.
Well, I don't know. We've got like 80 some odd schools, but
a few that are trying to be the holdouts.
Yeah, absolutely. But, you know, from a small school perspective, there's no other better option or platform than Squirtle.com. I know some of the bigger schools, they might be able to, you know, get away with the some of the other versions where you have to pay monthly, et cetera. But for us, we're traveling miles upon miles, and this is a great way for Nana and Grandpa and aunties and uncles and people from Florida to California to Michigan to Alaska to Texas, Spain. I'm trying to get to Barcelona. Anyways, but we appreciate y'all, you fine folks. Chris, before we go to break, I think we've got a few minutes here. Anything else you want to offer up before we start to break down the Woodward Boomers after this timeout?
No, I think just we've kind of covered what the Cashion Wildcats need to do to finish out this season. And it's just put your head down, go to work during the week, and then come out and perform on Friday nights, and the rest will take care of itself.
Yeah, absolutely love it. Drew, we'll have you bring in Drew's clues for us here right after the break as we break down the Boomers. Hang tight with us. Be right back. CWTV.
Support your school's Booster Club and get your business in front of thousands of potential customers.
Talk about a win-win.
Advertising packages start on this streaming station for less than $10 a game. Call 405-726-0835 or email adam@squirtle.com right now for more information.
Cashion FBC is a church seeking to grow in Christ and our love for the body of Christ. With ministries from children to youth to adults, we strive to present the gospel in an engaging and meaningful way. Sunday school meets at 9:45 a.m. and worship starts at 11 a.m. Children and youth meet on Wednesdays at 6 p.m. Please check our website at cashionfbc.org for more information, and we hope to see you this Sunday, located a half mile east of Cashion.
Oklahoma Career Tech's been serving up skills for doers just like you for over 100 years.
But this ain't your great Grammys of Pop Pop Tech School.
Oklahoma's favorite place to learn new skills keeps learning new tricks. Everyone knows the best way to learn is to do it yourself.
Sir, you okay?
Because you shouldn't have to wait to do what you love. Whatever you choose to do, do you. Oklahoma Career Tech.
Absolute Pools, Lawns, and Landscape is not your ordinary pool builder. From traditional to exotic and anything in between, our staff offers paramount quality and service through the entire design and build process. We provide service to the entire OKC metro and surrounding towns. So relax, knowing our team is wholeheartedly committed to building a trusting and lasting relationship with you. Visit us on Facebook or give us a call today at 405-285-9729. Absolute Pools, Lawns, and Landscape.
At Maples Nixon Diesel Horse, we've helped a lot of people, and our goal was to treat each and every person like a friend. And as a friend, we've got your back, always. We understand what you're going through. Being lawyers is what we do, but it's not all that we are. We care. We'll stand beside you throughout the entire legal process, not just as lawyers, but as your friends. We are Maples Nixon Diesel Horse, and we are here to help.
High school streaming service, Squirtle.tv. Find out more at Squirtle.com/stream.
Kyle and Gina Van Druff have the answers to all your real estate and insurance needs. These guys will have you covered in a one-stop shopping experience. They are local agents, local supporters, and active in the Cashion community. They are also proud parents of past and present Cashion students. Kyle and Gina help their clients make the right choice. Don't wait till it's too late. Call 405-607-4300. Go Wildcats and number 88. Let's have a great year.
Walk it up. Get you some.
I think that's 18. All right, welcome back, Cashion Wildcats TV 2022 Cashion Wildcats football. Appreciate you guys joining us tonight here live from Maxon Field in beautiful Cashion, Oklahoma. It's Neiman Ababi, Chris Gibson, and my man Drew Baker joining us here to complete the trio here, the three best friends have ever come back to roost back here in the press box. It is an absolutely gorgeous 76 degrees. I mean, it's amazing. So, you know, unlike last week where we were setting up outside and some, you know, it was a...
I had my shorts on because I forgot we weren't going to be in the press box.
I think last week, you know, we're just going to wrap this one up in a bow. It was just started off tough and it ended tough. And so, you know, it's a chance opportunity to kind of reset here against the Boomers. Coach Rick, is it Luton? Luton?
I believe so.
Luton. That's got to be Luton. Yeah. So
Lugen.
The Woodward Bombers, again, Class 4A, they're 0-7 on the season. But if you take a look at who they've played, they play Guthrie, Bethany, Newcastle, Cash, Weatherford, and Chickasha, as well as John Marshall. Those are some decent names just in football in general, not just Class 4A. They've had some difficulty, but certainly if you take a look out there, they don't lack size in terms of numbers or physical size. And it's a situation where I think the Wildcats will certainly, you know, we'll have to be all hands on deck. From the standpoint of the Boomers, you know, from your perspective, Chris, you watched a little bit of film. You know, what are your thoughts?
I mean, they're kind of throw a lot at you. You know, just watching film on them, I didn't think they looked that big. But then in my head, I was thinking they're playing bigger schools.
Yeah.
So that may be one reason they don't look that big. But you get out here now and you're looking out there, and they've got some size up on the line. And I think Drew said it a while ago. This is going to be a good prep game for Hinton. Yep,
it's
and
it's
Crescent,
exactly right. Yep.
Because this is going to be about the size of boys that you're going to see going against Hinton and Crescent. And I think they're going to probably try to run the ball a lot like Hinton and Crescent. Their offense kind of reminds me a lot of what Crescent likes to do.
Yep.
They like to pound the ball, and then they got a quarterback that is athletic enough that he can make some kids miss, go get some big yards, or pull it up and throw it down the field.
Yeah, amen to that. So, Chris, or Drew, you've been fantastic. That's why we miss you. You get the inside scoop. Did you have a chance to catch up with Coach Rick Luton? And the Boomers?
Yep. I was able to text him. You know, sometimes it's text, sometimes it's an email, sometimes it's, you know, a five-minute phone call. But I was able to kind of shoot him a couple of questions, and I just asked, you know, what was his initial thoughts on, you know, coming to play Cashion after the last-minute, you know, schedule change. And he talked about he was excited, you know, to get their open date field, and it was somebody that he knew. He had knew Coach Shackelford, so he was happy about that. And then I asked, you know, just what kind of his goal as a team was going to be, since it's not a district game, and, you know, it's probably going to be something you want to work on yourself a little bit while you're also playing. And he said, you know, they're 0-7 this year, and they played a lot of tough games, but they want their first win. But he said, you know, Cashion's never just the place you're going to count on that all the time. And I, you know, just asked him what was something in particular in practice this week he wanted to work on to prepare for Cashion. And he said, obviously, cover number 3. So they're going to try to cover up Max Brown, as I think most everybody else will at that point, and just get their offense to really kind of get in that fast-paced deal. But I am glad you brought up their quarterback, Chris, because their starting quarterback broke his leg the game before last. So their quarterback they have now is their really young QB, and he said that he's been good all the last 2 weeks playing and at practice, but they just said they're really ready for him to kind of feel more confident.
Yeah, that's number 12,
that
Ryan
role.
Douglas.
Yep.
He's
5'6",
135, so, you know, it'll be interesting to see. I don't know if Chris will have that as part of your keys of the game in terms of how he handles Preston Cotter and Jackson Vandruff.
Right. And then I just asked him, you know, because we haven't played Woodward, to my knowledge, in a long time, if ever. And so I just asked, you know, where all he had been as a coach. It's his fourth year at Woodward. He spent 10 years at Hennessy. That's how he got to know Shaq over those, you know, 10 years. 2 years before that, he was at Locust Grove, 3 years at Stigler, and 10 years in Kansas, and 2 years at Tyrone. So he's coached a lot of football over the last several years.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, Drew, we really appreciate you coming in and kind of give us the situation. Any general feel, I mean, in regards to maybe his approach to this game? I know you sort of mentioned that they were, you know, looking for the win. Is this something that, I mean, they're putting a lot of emphasis on for the team, or is this a deal where they're just trying to get some reps?
Oh, I think for sure. I mean, like he talked about, they're 0-7 this year. So, obviously, you know, you want to get that first win. I mean, we're kind of getting down to the nut-cutting time in this part of that season just because, you know, a lot of people don't have very many games left. So, I think, yeah, they probably spent a lot of time preparing this week, as anybody should. So, I'm sure they're going to actually, you know, come out and not just do it for reps and actually try and get, you know, a win on their record.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, we're grateful. I mean, a situation where we had no game, to a game at Stillwater against the Stillwater JV, to now against the Boomers. I think this is honestly the best case scenario for the Cashion Wildcats. We get a home game. We get to be here in beautiful Cashion, Oklahoma. And we've got a team where, in essence, that can, as Chris, as you alluded to, can kind of give us some looks of what we might see in size-wise and scheme-wise, like we might see with Hinton and Crescent down the road. Chris, from your perspective, from the Boomers, I mean, any players stand out? You know, I know Drew had mentioned a couple folks.
Yeah, I didn't get name of my players to watch or keys to the game in time. We had a crazy week, and which everybody in the world has crazy weeks, but I shouldn't have excuses, but that's my excuse. Anyway, so I'm just going to kind of walk you through this as we're watching them warm up here. I had Mark pan over. If you see number one out there, it's Taylen Laird. He is going to be the guy that they're going to throw the ball to a lot, hit the ball in his hands. He's been one of their playmakers the last 2 years, and he's going to be one that they're really going to try to get the ball in his hands and let him do work. You see him, he's up there at the top of the, if you see on the far side, he's a big, really good-looking receiver that is very athletic, and he's going to be their free safety on the defensive side of the ball that's going to really be back there trying to ball hawk and go knock down balls. And you see right there, he's got good hands and catches that for the Boomers as they are finishing up their warm-up. Then I just put on their 12, Ryan Douglas, their sophomore quarterback, to watch. We'll see, like you said, Nima, how he handles having Preston Cotter and Jackson Vanderf really getting into his face tonight, he's kind of getting thrown to the fire here as a young quarterback in 4A, and we've seen a lot of young quarterbacks this year. You know, we've seen a lot of freshmen. This one for a 4A school to be starting a sophomore, I know there's been some injuries, but this kid is going to be kind of the future of what the Woodward Boomers are going to be, and he's athletic, can throw the ball, and make some kids miss and get up the field. So keep an eye on him on the offensive side of the ball. He's going to be one to watch for the Woodward Boomers.
Yeah, I love it. So we're watching them as they go through their kind of defensive warm-ups. You mentioned it, and it's been crazy. I mean, we have seen three freshman quarterbacks, Thomas, Western Heights, as well as
Watonga.
And here's a sophomore. I think, we mention this all the time, right? It's always nice. The Jimmies and the Joes can make up for a lot of things. And, you know, this is one of those situations where the Wildcats, if you look back at some of our biggest wins, they've been against teams that have more inexperienced, younger quarterbacks, where Tony's dialing up that defense, getting after it, and allowing for some of those guys to get after it. And really, you know, giving Chance Acord and the offense more opportunities to get the ball back is certainly key. On defense, you know, it'll be a situation where, you know, right now you're seeing some guys emerge. Obviously, we've talked about the Twin Towers, Preston Cotter, as well as Jackson Vandriff, of course. Jackson Vandriff getting a lot of pub as well on the Mark Rogers midday show. Coach Shaq was on there doing an interview. But ultimately, it's guess who? Camden Maroney leading the team in tackles this year. Jake Branson right behind him. So it certainly will have to be a team effort, as you know, there is some talented athletic guys that may, here on the Boomers, who may not have had a chance to shine because of their rotation at quarterback.
Yeah, the Boomers, they've had a tough schedule. You go look at the schedule that they've had. I mean, they're playing some of the better teams. I know John Marshall, maybe they've struggled a little bit over the last few years. But other than that, man, they've had a pretty tough schedule. They actually were in 5A last year and moved down to 4A, and I think their coach thought they were going to have some opportunity, but I think they're kind of going through some growing pains, and at some point, you know, hopefully can get the ball rolling there. But defensively, you know, they kind of run that 3-4 look, and I think Shaq is going to be able to dial up some stuff tonight. Just from some of the film that I've watched, I hopefully we can get some little bit of running game going and maybe throw the ball down the field some.
All right, so a great breakdown of the Woodward Boomers here. Appreciate you guys joining us here on Cash and Wildcats TV, where Wildcats looking to get back to 500, sitting at 3-4 right now in an out-of-district game. Just a kind of a weird – it's been a weird season, just FYI.
It has been.
Weird season.
Well, any season that we have one loss is like, what is going on here?
What's going on here?
Yeah, it's certainly been the case, and I think we've been playing Dr. Phil to each other, Chris and I, regarding trying to make sure that we're able to stay through. Hey, and we appreciate you guys joining us again. This is Homer Television for the Cash and Wildcats. For those boomers that are joining us, this it's CWTV. We'll try our best, certainly, to call the game. But we're going to get a little bit excited for the Wildcats when they do well. And when things don't go our way, we might be a little bit upset. But certainly appreciate you guys doing your thing and joining us here. And we're going to take a quick commercial break. Hang tight with us as we come back and break down the Cash and Wildcats. Get the lowdown on from Coach Shaq in the locker room, and we'll get you ready for kickoff here in about 25 minutes. Be back right after this.
Now is the time to protect your family with Pioneer Smart Wi-Fi. Internet security is becoming more of a fear every day. Protect your family against malware, viruses, intrusions, cyber attacks, and more. Modern internet deserves modern security. Get the best of both worlds with Pioneer in-home Wi-Fi and the Smart Wi-Fi app. Download the Pioneer Smart Wi-Fi app today or visit gopioneer.com for more information.
Dr. Matt Dieselhorst at Dieselhorst Sports and Orthopedics can help you get game day ready. Dr. Dieselhorst works with athletes of all ages, taking a coordinated approach to accelerate return to play and maximize athletic performance. His work with pros in sports training, injury prevention, bracing, functional rehabilitation, and imaging works seamlessly with his medical and surgical expertise. Get started by going to Dieselhorst Sports and Orthopedics. Let Dr. Matt Dieselhorst get you back on the field, backing all Oklahoma athletes on the field and off.
Storm season is coming, people, and your first choice for roofing needs should be Rhino Roofing. Locally owned and operated, the Rhino specializes in all types of repair and replacement. Large scale, traditional, modern, unique roof lines, they can do it all. Protect your home and your family with the specialized services of Rhino Roofing. Visit our Facebook page today and make an appointment. Rhino Roofing is all the hype for any roof type.
Looking for a solution to your water well problem or just needing a new well drilled? Western Drilling does water well drilling and repair. They are experts in pumping system installation, troubleshooting, and repair. Western Drilling works with domestic, ag, and irrigation wells. Give them a call today and explore all the solutions. Western Drilling supports Cashion High School. Go Wildcats!
Legacy Insurance and Financial Services is proud to be on Main Street in Cashion, Oklahoma, supporting our Wildcats while riding business throughout Oklahoma and surrounding states. Legacy agents who share over 40 years of experience will shop many carriers to fulfill all of your insurance and investment needs. We welcome face-to-face meetings, but if your needs require an online virtual relationship, we are versed at those too. Let the team of Chris Gibson, Chris Cochran, Aaron Phoenix, and Christina Branson at Legacy Insurance and Financial Services help you build your own legacy, one you will be proud to live and to leave.
All right, welcome back to Maxson Field in beautiful Cashion, Oklahoma, where we have Cashion Wildcat Football 2022 live on a Thursday night, our second Thursday night in a row. It's kind of a weird deal.
Which
here.
I love it.
You, of course, you love it.
I love it. I get to do Cashion and the pay dirt deal, so I love it.
You know, there's something about Thursday nights. I'm just, my memories of Thursday nights in college even, just, it's not the weekend, but it's like pre-weekend. It's kind of nice. I'm not gonna lie. You know, the Fridays having a Friday off is actually kind of nice too as well. So,
well, you probably are gonna travel tomorrow, aren't you?
No, not tomorrow. But yes, we have in the past. Tomorrow, OBU plays Saturday plays at Southeastern at Durant.
Durant.
It's not a bad drive at all. It's about 3.5 hours. So. We appreciate that, but we appreciate you guys joining us here at on a Thursday night. Here's the Wildcats, 3-4, looking to move to 4-4 out of district against the 0-7 4A Woodward Boomers. Boomers! And we appreciate you guys joining us here. So we just broke down the Boomers a little bit, talked to you a little bit about a team that we may not have a whole lot of understanding, but a team that we do know and love is the Cashion Wildcats. And we had a little bit of breakdown about Grudding last week. And Drew, you had your inside scoop in the locker room. What did Coach Shaq kind of offer up to you as we've licked our wounds and get ready here for the back end of the year?
Well, I just kind of – there were some people that were like, so how are we playing Woodward on a Thursday? I thought we had Stillwater JV. And so I asked him, you know, how did that transpire? Just because a lot of people didn't know, some people knew. And he just said, we were supposed to play OCA. They dropped football this year, unfortunately. And so they scheduled Stillwater JV, but Stillwater JV stipulations were, okay, we're only playing you if you come to Stillwater, which, you know, you can't blame
like Stillwater.
Yeah, you can't blame him for that. And so then he got to looking at the schedule and saw that Woodward had an open game and was like, hey, let's see if we can make that work. And they decided to come here, so that gave us 5 home games instead of the 4 we were going to have originally. So he was pretty excited about that. And then as far as this game not being a district game, what's the goal or the thing that, you know, Cashion needs to focus on tonight? He just said, we want to continue to try and get better. Woodward's bigger, and they're going to be a lot more physical, he thought. He said, much like Hinton and Crescent might be. So he said it'll be a good opportunity, like we had all talked about beforehand, you know, to see what they're going to play the last 2 district games. And then, you know, obviously, barring other major things, I said, you know, what did you think that Cashion did well last week, even though CHA came away with the win? He said they played their best game all year, that he thought, in a lot of ways. He said they were more physical than they had been, and we did a great job versus the run.
Absolutely.
I think they only had like 10 yards rushing in the first half.
So, I mean, you could take that away in a positive note. And then I just asked, you know, what players improved the most up to this point in the season? Because, I mean, we're getting into the latter half of it here. And he said he thinks Chance is playing really well right now, and he seems to be getting more comfortable with playing QB, like we talked about when we did the preseason scrimmage. This is his first year doing 11-man football, so, you know, there's going to be that adjusting curve. But he also said Timmy Jones is another player that's improved a lot at the linebacker since the start of the position.
He's gotten more physical as the year has gone on.
I know. I think he's always been physical. I think he's just playing faster now. Yeah. I think he is. I think he's getting
more fast-paced physical.
Yeah, absolutely. Speaking of Chance, you know, Chance was 16 for 23 for 235, had a couple touchdowns, had a really costly interception there right at midfield. But, you know, you mentioned him. It was his 16 carries and 44 yards and a touchdown early on. That kind of helped set the pace for the Wildcats. Chris and I talked about the fact that we like we've always appreciated scanning the field, going to your second and third options, but that internal clock's got to move. You got to get moving, and we've seen him pull that. He's pulled on the zone read. He's kept it.
Yeah.
He's run a little bit, and you've seen him kind of get out of the pocket and pick up some crucial yards. I love Coach offering that up regarding Chance, and we certainly have seen that, and that will pay dividends not only into the playoffs, but definitely going into next year
for sure.
As he's only a junior. Last week as well, we didn't get to mention what did we talk about in terms of what else can we say about Max Brown? I mean, the guy on the season right now, if we take a look, he's got right around a 600, 700 yards receiving, rushing wise. He's right around, you know, 290. He's averaging right around 25 yards a carry. It's ridiculous. Last week, he had 8 receptions for 126 yards, 1 touchdown, and we stopped going to him. That was the deal. We had gotten him pretty good. I felt like we went away from Max Brown.
We came out at halftime and fed him the ball 2 or 3 times in a row, and then just kind of went away from it. And I think maybe Shaq saw him trying to really take him away, but at some point you just got to give the ball in the hands of your best player and see what can happen.
Absolutely. All right, so from his standpoint,
is that everything Coach Shaq had?
Yeah, that was really everything he had. He was just, you know, we kind of talked about districts a little bit, but I'll let him break down what he was thinking about on that more when he comes up after the game.
Hey, listen, we want to do one quick thing. Again, it gets heated around here on Cashion Wildcat TV, and it's because we love our Cashion boys, right? We love our teams.
Oh, yeah.
And it's no doubt a lot of times we have family members that are even on the team. Chris, I know you can't wait till Maddox is playing high school varsity football to be up here on the.
I just don't know if my heart rate can handle it. I get, you know, before the junior high games, Maddox is seventh grade this year, so he's in the playing junior high game. Even before the CASA football game, my heart rate would be at 100 miles an hour, and I'm not even playing the game or anything. I don't know. Is it just like that when your son's playing?
Absolutely. But I think it's also the competitor in you, right? That's a good sign. I always tell my kids that's a great sign when you feel like you got to throw up or you got to pee and poop at the same time, you know, that you got the nerves. That means you care, that you're out there, that you're trying to think about it. But you know, we absolutely cannot do this without our officials. You know, one of the things that comes out here is that we definitely know that we're not perfect, and we don't expect our officials to be perfect, but certainly want to make sure. And Chris, I know you're going to give a shout out here like you always do every week, but tonight's officials will be Lonnie Brickman, referee, Brandon Moreland, umpire, Brandon Bermia, head linesman, Isaac Estrada, line judge, and Alexis Nelms, the back judge. That's always our most popular official, it seems like, back judge. But we really appreciate our officials. And Chris, what do we always say about our umpires and referees out here during the games?
These officials, you cannot play the games without the officials out here administering the rules. And if you don't have them, the kids don't have an opportunity to get out and compete on the field of play. And so we appreciate them coming out and giving of their time and effort. I say it every week, they don't make a living off of this. They do make a little bit of, pretty much covers gasoline to get to where they're going. So we appreciate them coming out and giving the kids an opportunity. And I've said it over and over, if you think you can do better, which sometimes I think that, but if you think you can do better and you have the time, the officiating crews would appreciate you coming, you know, signing up. There's places to Google it up, how to become an official in Oklahoma for high school football, and it will pull up and give you all the information, because I guarantee you, if you ask them that you want to join, they will give you a striped shirt and a whistle.
Yep, absolutely.
So,
absolutely.
No, we appreciate all they do.
For sure. I've got a family member that does high school football every Thursday and Friday night as well, brother-in-law. He and I get into fights about rules and calls and stuff like that. You ought to watch us when we were at college games. It's pretty interesting. But nonetheless, at minimum, if you'd like to do it, just come to a game. If you're at a game, just talk to one of the officials. Come ask me. We'll get you a phone number. But the idea is that, again, we appreciate our officials. During the broadcast, we try to keep it as positive as we can because it is for the kids, and we're trying to provide a nice insight into our wonderful community. But certainly we love our Cash and Wildcats, and we're as competitive as anyone else. So the idea of getting after it doesn't stop here in the press box. But we're going to take a quick time out. Looks like we've got about, we got smoke going. We've got about 10 minutes before kickoff. We'll have the national anthem. Hang tight with us. We'll be right back. Cash and Wildcats TV.
Wiggins, Sewell, and Ogletree is dedicated to championing our clients through complicated and challenging litigations. We pride ourselves on a proven track record of success brought forth by fierce litigation skills. The lawyers and staff of our firm are dedicated to effective and personalized representation for every client who entrusts our service. uncompromising integrity, unparalleled results. Call Wiggins, Sewell, and Ogletree, 405-232-1211.
Founded by Jesse and Amy McCracken, Rural Pest Solutions is a Cashion-based, family-owned and operated company. Our focus is on providing the highest level of customer service while effectively treating many common invaders, including spiders, ants, roaches, mice, mosquitoes, fleas, ticks, and termites. Flexible scheduling and superior customer service are our top priority. Call us today to schedule your appointment, 405-283-6565.
Stream with Oklahoma's number one high school streaming service, Skordle.tv. Find out more at Skordle.com/stream.
Todd Miller, and this is Grain & Grange, still the coolest furniture store you've never heard of. Come see us.
All right, welcome back. Cashion Wildcat TV live from Maxson Field, where we've got Thursday night football. Neiman Abibi, Chris Gibson, Drew Baker bringing tonight's action as the Wildcats taking on the 4A Boomers visiting Maxson Field. And man, that was an impressive commercial there.
Todd Miller.
Yo, yeah. Todd Miller.
Getting it done.
Fantastic football sponsor.
Hey, I think, Todd, I think those are actually on
TV. Like
regular yeah, they
TV.
Are.
Like,
yeah. Yeah.
Well, this is regular TV.
This is regular TV.
So what are you talking about?
My bad. Just messing. No, we love Todd Miller. We joke. You know, he's got his store there over off of I-40 over there on the Yukon Mustang side, and he's got now all of his – he's going to own the stockyards here in a second. He's going to own everything south of there, and – absolutely love everything he does out there. We love all of our fantastic sponsors. We saw Jesse McCracken. We see Jesse right now. He's got his Dr. Pepper and Sonic Burger hanging out here. But Jesse McCracken, Rural Pest Solutions, love those guys. And, again, all of our fantastic sponsors who make this free of charge. But appreciate it. So we've broken down Boomers, broken down the Wildcats from a standpoint. What are, you know, Chris, this is the time of the night before the game kicks off in terms of we talk about keys to the game. So on offense for the Wildcats to go to 4-4, what are we going to have to see here tonight?
Now, offensively, I want to see us really going against this bigger group. I want to see our kids. We're going to have to run the ball some, establish some of the run game. We don't have Nathan Abibi. He got a concussion last week, so and that's pretty much – I mean, I can tell people that he's out, right?
Yeah,
because, out. I mean, not because he wants to be. It's because the doctor said no more. So without him back there, we're going to have to find somebody that can really run the ball and gain
– Well, it's been running back going. By committee all yeah. year, so I mean
– It has. It has. Yeah. But without – that's one less option back
that's
there.
That's true.
And so we really need to find somebody or something – some way to establish some sort of – some remnants of a run game. And then I think my next key for the Cashion offense is, you know, let Chance throw the ball down the field. Let's see. I'll say it. I'm kind of like a broken record. I want to see him throw that ball 10, 15-yard routes down the field, you know, after the whole long play, you know, the call last week.
Yeah.
And it was third and 30.
Yeah.
You know, that was a beautiful pass where he just took two steps, stepped up in the pocket, hit Cooper over the middle for 25 yards. That's the kind of thing I want to see on a regular basis. And so I think if we can show any kind of a run game, I think that's going to open up for the Cashion Wildcats, and he's going to be able to throw the ball down the field and have some success.
I love it.
And then on the defensive side of the ball, I want to just see the key is just get after the quarterback. He's a young quarterback that's kind of just been thrown in there the last two games. You get Jackson Vanderf and Preston Cotter, we've talked about them over and over, just putting pressure on that quarterback. I think he's going to make some mistakes. And so my second key to the defense is go get the football. When it's in the air, he's going to be pressured. Those boys are going to get to him. When the ball floats, you go get it. get some interceptions. You've got to have some turnovers in this game to win the ball game tonight.
I love it. You know, a great point regarding that running situation. Nathan Abavi was the leading rusher on the team right around, I want to say, it looks like, if I take a look, if I look, almost about 360 yards, average about 5.5 a carry. So I certainly would love to see that. Looks like we're going to have our national anthem here as captains and the band head off to the field. We'll get you moved towards the field and get you ready for halftime or a pregame band festivities.
And the pride of Cashion as they play our national anthem. Please remain standing as they play your Cashion Wildcat fight song.
God bless America, greatest country in the entire universe. So blessed to be here. And we're so blessed to have you guys join us here on another great night of Cashion Wildcat football here on CWTV. Again, Nima, Chris, and Drew bringing tonight's action as the Wildcats 4-4 taking on the 0-7 4A Woodward Boomers. So we've broken down the Boomers. We've broken down the Wildcats. We've talked about keys to the game, players to watch for the Boomers. And so, Chris, this is the best part of the pregame is your prediction. So, from your standpoint, breaking it all down, what are your thoughts, and, so, and what are the Cashion Wildcats going to do tonight?
Before the prediction, my best part is when I give my little girls a shout out, and my beautiful wife Ashley is at home with the girls watching. Olivia, Avery, Madeline, love you girls. Have to throw that in there. They're watching right now. So anyway, love you girls, and go to bed early for Mama. Guys, tonight is a game we've talked about that doesn't matter as far as playoff standings. It doesn't matter. It's not a district game. But what does matter is these boys are getting an opportunity to get out here and play tonight and get some things right. And I think the Cashion Wildcats, if they will get out here and execute like I know they can after watching film, I think the Cashion Wildcats are going to come away victorious okay. against this 4A team. And it's going to be 34. You ready? 17.
Okay, I'll take it. 34-17. I like it.
They've got a kicker that I think if early on, yeah. if they get close yeah. enough, I think they might try to kick a field goal or two. So, I just really think the Cashion Wildcats have a great opportunity here to go against a bigger school that has some size and to really continue to get more physical every game. That way, as you round out the season with those two big opponents, that's going to really help the Wildcats have this under their belt experience-wise and to get more physical as the season continues.
I love it. I love it. I'll take it. So at midfield, the Wildcats in their maroon helmets, gold tops, maroon pants, your Clayton Harmon traditional look here. I think there's a lot of Cashion alums that love this look here. Looks like the Wildcats did win the toss, and we deferred. Wow!
Which that's been
the
strategy.
That's right, that's right. So
I would say this was the first time, but we did it last week, too.
Hey, when he did that the last game, I was like, am I even watching the right stream right now? What's going on?
So Wildcat captains, all seniors, Camden Maroney, Max Brown, Preston Cotter, Jackson Vandruff, and Seth Gilbert out there. We do win the toss. They'll take pictures there with the Cashion State or Community State Bank kickoff kid here Nice work there. Love seeing Leah Harmon out there as well. Always a great ambassador and our scoreboard sponsor here at Cash and Wildcats TV all season long in football
and basketball. At Maxenfield.
And Max and Billy Garley.
Got all the scoreboards covered.
Yeah, I need to get in the banking industry. Yeah, I guess. I might be able to take care of it. But, again, we appreciate you guys joining us here. Wildcats, again, winning the toss. They will defer. They'll be kicking off to the Boomers, moving from west to east. Again, the Wildcats here on a beautiful night. Golly, it's dipped a little bit to 71, but literally no wind at all. And you know what? If you ask for a fall evening, this might be it.
Yeah, no doubt. Just I always say Friday nights and playing football is great. Thursday nights playing football is great, too, and especially when the weather is like it is, no wind, 70 degrees, and the boys are just fired up and ready to get after it. And you got to love Friday night football or Thursday night football and high school football, and there's no better place to be than at a football game that's high school. Great atmosphere that loves what they do.
Yep. One other key note, we talked about Nathan Abavi, starting center, sophomore Caden Seeley is out with a foot injury. Caden quietly has had a really good season thus far. Big shame. So we'll have to see what Coach Shaq and the bunch do as they reshuffle the offensive line around to make up for number 63, the sophomore. Just a big shout out for him. Hoping to maybe have him back later in the season. We'll see how things go.
Yeah, I mean, apparently it is a foot injury. I'm not sure the extent of it, but there is hope that he will be back for the Hinton game. So let's everybody kind of keep him in your thoughts and prayers, and hopefully he can get back out there and help the Cashion Wildcats on to the in that playoff push.
So a team that was thin already to start with is even thinner now. But Wildcats, they've got a lot of gamers here. It's time to dig deep and find out who else can make it happen. So kicking off for the Wildcats, Chandler Christensen out there, number six, does a fantastic job. The Boomers look like they have about 50 people out there, but it's probably 11. It is 12. Hey, listen, my visual acuity was correct. So number two, actually, running back Ace Long. You'll see him in the Wildcat quite a bit. He actually takes a step off. Number 25, that is Hayden Hiller, the junior 5'9", 165, is the up back right around the 30-yard line, most likely going to be the intended receiver. Deep is Taylen Laird. Kick will go to Laird. The senior will work to his right side, coming back through. Uh-oh. Big hole coming back through. Nice tackle there. Great job coming off of the block. And we'll give credit to
is that Creed Kastner?
It is. No, it looks like nope. No, that's Ty Gilbert. Gilbert. Ty Gilbert with the tackle. And so with that, we've got first quarter action started. Wildcats on defense. It'll be first and 10. And it looks like it'll be starting off here right at the 35-yard line.
Yeah, you saw Laird there with that run, and you saw how physical he was going down there. He's going to get the ball in his hands, like I said. He's going to be the one to kind of watch. And if we can kind of keep him contained, I think we'll have some success on defense.
So we'll have Ryan Douglas, the sophomore, under center. We'll see this jumbo package here with the motion coming through. Handoff underneath. Running back number two dips his head. Give credit to Ace Long on a big tackle. We have a fumble. Will Cashin does recover, and what a start. Jackson, or looks like Jake Branson with the recovery, and how about that for the Wildcats?
Yeah, great start on the defense for the defense there. The kid had a good hard run, had a little crease there, hit it hard, but somebody came up there and hit hard enough to knock that ball out, and Jake Branson comes away with it from underneath the pile and gives the Cashin Wildcats a good starting position here for their first offensive drive.
So Wildcats taking over at the Woodward 42-yard line. Chance Acord, the junior, back in shotgun with him will be junior. We mentioned him earlier, Cooper Frazee. Wildcats going double tight end set here with Gilbert and Brown out here to the right. Looks like pull, give to Cooper. He's going to get to the outside. He's trying to escape the grasp of the linebacker coming in. Slow down, eventually tackled by number 12. Looks like we got, what's going on here, a dislocated shoulder or something.
Number 44, he's going to be one of those guys on defense, Lewis Coral. He's a senior, and he's one of their big playmakers up on the front line. Looks like he reached out to grab Cooper, and it just kind of pulled his elbow out in his socket or something there. And had trouble getting up, but he didn't come out.
So that'll be a no gain, second and 10 here for the Wildcats. Wildcats go ace up on either side. Shotgun, another handoff to Frazee. Tripped up at the line. Looks like Max Hickton got him on that one.
as Frazee falls forward for a couple, and that'll bring up third down and long.
And so one of my keys was, you know, establish a run game, and that's exactly what Coach Shackford's trying to do there on first and second down. And we only picked up about 2 yards.
Back to pass is Acord on a slant, finds his man, and guess who? Max Brown. That'll be a first down, Cashion Wildcats.
Yeah, great job right there by Chance of just stepping into that throw. Max runs a great route right there, and we've seen that time and time again, that in route to Max, and they always connect.
Frazee with a handoff, looks to the outside, gets to the corner. It might be a horse collar. It's not their ball is loose. They'll say it's down, thankfully. Give credit to number one, Taylen Laird, who grabs Frazee from the shoulder pads from behind and throws him down. No call. It'll be a short gain. Well, actually, a nice gain of 6 yards.
Yeah, he got to that edge and got around and was able to turn it up there before Laird got to him. That's kind of why Laird had to grab him from behind there.
In the pistol, Acord will hand it off to Frazee. Nice cutback against the linebacker. We'll move it across, gets positive yards as number 44, Lewis Corral. We talked about him, was the first in the backfield. Frazee hits the ankle, gets upfield, and a big third and one. Wildcats here in a hurry up with 9:53 driving, four down territory. Acord and shotgun, he'll give it back to.
And flag we'll on the play out there.
False start, and that's the dilemma, going fast, right?
Yeah, false start there. I guess, wonder if that was on one of the boys out there split out. It's kind of what he's showing. Now, those guys got to watch that ball go on the movement of the ball. And, you go any time before that, those guys, those line judges are going to call that every single time.
So we've got Seth Gilbert in at okay, we might get our free five back. We sure
there
do. Nice work. Wildcats have done a great job this year doing that. From an alignment perspective, we see Kai Gilbert in at tight end along with Max Higdon. So no Camden Maroney in on the offensive side thus far. We've seen him in the H-back.
Hey, I just want to say, you see these officials tonight, how they're moving and coming and communicating?
Yep.
That's what I like to see. That shows professionalism right there at its best and at its finest. And I think this crew is going to be one that will do a great job tonight.
Acord coming back, finds Higdon, the tight end. That might be Higdon's first catch of the season. That's inbounds. It'll be a short gain if no gain. And I'll bring
short,
up third.
Yeah, I was going to say short gain or no, because he kind of caught that right behind the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, I don't think they moved the marker a little
box
bit.
The box at all, did they? Yeah.
So fourth and one, big down here for the Wildcat offense. High snap. Frazee with the catch. He's looking to find room. He does. Scoots forward. Oh, my God. Chicken poop into chicken salad. First down. Cashion Wildcats. Cooper Frazee playing a little center field. Gets the first down.
Yeah, Cooper just made the best of it there. You talked about Seelig being out. The center position is very important because if you don't get that ball in the hands of the quarterback, it could be bad things happen.
Speaking of quarterback, Chance had a good little block there for Cooper.
So give inside to Acord, or from Acord to Frazee. And speaking of linemen, speaking of the devil, Camden Maroney's got his number 61 back as he finds his way to left guard. Tommy Branson filling in at center, second and five here. Wildcats going fast. Screenplay back into Brown, trying to get a block to the outside. Cuts back in, stiff arm, and he falls right out of bounds, right around the 2 yard line. That's going to be close to a first down. Let's see if they get it.
It will be first down. Good hard run right there by Max once he got the ball in his hands. He made a guy miss and looked like he was going to be able to spin his way into the end zone. They were able to get him down about the 2 yard line.
Crazy handoff over the goal line. Touchdown, Cashion Wildcats. 2 yard punch by Cooper Frazee, and the Wildcats are on the board.
Yeah, good job by Cooper right there, finding the seam and just sticking his head down there and getting over the goal line for the Cashion Wildcat touchdown.
All right, so what started at the Woodward 42, it is a 42-yard drive, going about nine plays. Wildcats convert on a fourth down, on a crazy fourth down. Brian Nababi on the hold. Chandler Christensen with the kick. Beautiful. Wildcats up 7-0.
Yeah, and, you know, you don't want to take that for granted. You want to appreciate those extra points because last week we missed four extra points. You make two of those or three of those and you win the ball game despite everything else that went on. So do not take for granted kicking extra points is not easy. You got to have a good snap, good hold, and the kicker's got to come through for you. It's not just a kick. There's a lot of moving parts there. And so those kids really work on that and pride themselves in getting better after that game. And you saw it right there. It paid off with a great kick and a great hold. A great snap, hold, and kick there for the Cashion Wildcats.
big time. Wildcats, again, a 42-yard drive took up about 3.5 minutes as the Wildcats had that one play, got the fumble. Drew, you pretty happy?
Yo, I'm way pumped about that. That was just – I hated to see the fumble – or not the fumble, the five-yard penalty there just because I saw it last week. The momentum, we were doing so good, playing so fast, just gets stalled by something like that. But I think it worked out pretty well because we got that 5 yards back almost right afterwards.
Nice work. Wildcats have been pretty good with that, drawing people off. So give Chance Acord some credit and give the line some props for staying still. So Christensen kicking off from the 40. Again, last time it was number one. That was Taylen Laird with the return. They've actually flipped this time, and it looks like we've got number 13, Carson Medina, deep. Let's see if Christensen goes high onside, short onside, deep. He's going to go deep. That will go to Medina. He'll get at the 10. He'll go back to his right, looking for a lane. Gilbert on the outside, trying to get that edge. Max Higdon out there, breaks free, and brought down by Jake Branson eventually, and that'll be deep into, near midfield, so it'll be first down and 10
for
the Boomers.
There is a flag on the field. I don't know if it was a legal block or a hold.
Yep.
A lot of times when a guy catches it on the near side and takes it all the way across the field, it's hard for those blockers up front to stay in front without holding, and it looks like one of the Boomers was caught holding on that play, and they're going to back up that great return there.
All right, so Wildcats with the penalty go back out on defense. 7:53 here, first quarter action. Wildcats first possession going 42 after the turnover, after the fumble, taking advantage. For the Wildcats, looks like we've got a four-man front. Preston Cotter, Jackson Vandriff on the edge. We've got Matthew Stockton, Tommy Branson on the inside. Branson, Maroney, and Timmy Jones at linebacker, along with Gilbert on the overhang, both Gilberts. Frazee at corner, as well as Max Brown. Inside handoff, stuffed at the line. Great job by the defense. Camden Maroney, hello.
Great job right there by Camden Preston. Just really met him at the point of attack there at the line of scrimmage. And there was nothing going for the Boomer running back there with those two guys there to finish off the play.
You know, we saw a lot when the passing game wasn't working for them. They went straight to the Wildcat with a couple power backs, a couple H-backs. We'll see where Coach Luchin comes to that. But right now it's going to stay in that quarterback under center, who is, again, the sophomore Ryan Douglas, deep in the backfield, number two, Ace Long. In motion here. Looks like we got a movement there. I don't think Jackson was offside. Let's see what the call is. We'll call. We do have false start, so.
Yep.
Hey, tell me this.
Yes, I'll tell you anything.
If the offensive line and the defensive line, if it's simultaneous, who's the penalty on?
Well, we have to have neutral zone infraction, and then if he gets in the neutral zone, that's automatic offsides by the defense. Otherwise,
so if it's tied, does tie go to the runner or to the offense?
In the essence, it goes to the defense, as the offense will get called. But I don't. But see, Jackson didn't cross the neutral zone, so
Jackson reacted to.
The reason I asked in the junior high game, they called offsides and neutral zone infraction, and they just offsetting penalties.
Branson, with the pressure, great job there by the senior linebacker coming up to give Ryan Douglas heck, and that one will fall incomplete.
I was just trying to learn.
The way you started it was junior high football. That's the way you started it. So I'm sorry.
I didn't think it was correct, but I was trying to learn. And you know what?
And that's where you have people learning how to officiate, right?
And so I appreciate that. I completely understand. I was just trying to figure out.
See, now you know.
I got you. You're asking the wrong guy. I've got an opinion, but I don't have
I need to ask your brother-in-law. Yeah, he's the official.
That's
he's
right. I don't have the book, but I have the opinion. So third and 15, 6:47, the clock stops here. Wildcats going to pin their ears back. Camden Maroney actually out in defense out here on the edge on number one. They're going to zone up. Max Brown up top with the INT. Turnover number two. Wildcats are working on defense.
Yeah, that time I told you, we're going to put pressure on that quarterback. He's going to throw some balls up that you're going to have an opportunity to intercept. You got to go up and do that. And Max Brown did just that. He set back, waited to high point that ball, and when it got there, he went up and got it with strong hands, brought it down, and got the ball. Another turnover, two possessions for the Boomers, two turnovers in a row for the Cashion Wildcat defense.
All right, so a little intricacy there. Coach Wood bringing Camden Maroney out there to jam up the intended receiver, Taylen Laird. It was Max Brown with another interception. I believe that's his second of the year. So first and 10 from the 43 on the Woodward side of it. Good side of the business. Wildcats first and 10. Max Brown aced out by himself. Let's see what happens here as Acord will go back to pass across the middle. Max Higdon tied in. Second career catch. It's a touchdown for the sophomore, Max Higdon. 43-yard dump to Higdon from Acord, and the Wildcats add another to the board.
Tight end pop pass. I love it. I mean, I don't know if he was lined up in the tight end position, but that was kind of what that was there. And just came wide open. Nobody really even touched him off the line of scrimmage. And then Chance did a great job of putting the ball on him and had a great block down the field by Max Brown to really spring him all the way to the end zone.
Snap, hold is good. Good job there by freshman Brian Abadi getting that back on the tee. It's Christensen putting it through in the Wildcats. One play, 43 yards, two touchdowns off of two turnovers, and the Wildcats are dealing early here in the first quarter.
Yeah, great job by the defense to put the ball back in the hands of the offense. And whenever they put the ball back in the offense, that's in Cashion fashion right there, scoring on long drives very quick, or long plays very quickly. And Max Higdon gets in the end zone for the first time, probably in varsity uniform. Yeah, yeah. And you could tell he was pumped up after the fact. Let me try to get to the
I heard Cheyenne. I could hear replay. Her from the beginning. So, yeah, absolutely. So, again, the tight end coming into play here for the Wildcats.
I think here's the play right here. If you watch, he is lined up in that tight end position. Nobody covers him. And he is just wide open there for Chance to hit him for the touchdown. Let me see. Maybe I have it.
We have got the field view here. We've got the field cam. I would go back.
Yeah. So he comes off that left side of the line, just lined up in that tight end position.
Big block there.
Big block. I said Max Brown did a great job to get down there and really spring him into the end zone. So great job by the sophomore, Max Higdon, to get in the end zone for the Cashion Wildcat touchdown.
Gets his first catch the series before at varsity, and now the second one's a touchdown. Maybe Grandpa will give him a $100 bill. Christensen, big kick. That one's going to go to the 15. Intended receiver or returner is number 13, Medina. He's tackled by Jackson Vandruff and Kai Gilbert. Seth Gilbert, I apologize. So it'll be first and 10 here, third possession here. This one at the 30-yard line of Woodward.
Yeah, that time you see the the return man, he didn't try to cut it all the way across the field. I think that's kind of what their game plan is on the returns, the way that was set up there. But we had good coverage. He had to turn it back into kind of the teeth of where our return team was, and Jackson Vandruff was there to bring him down.
All right, so Wildcats return to defense. Four-man front here. We talked about that here earlier. With Tonga, it looks like they're going to go in shotgun now with Ryan Douglas. Ace Long, the freshman, 5'11", 180, running back to the right of him. Wildcats showing blitz here. Actually, five-man front, nowhere to run. Give credit to Ace Long. He finds a small lane in between Jake Branson and looks like Jackson Vandruff. Give credit there. Looks like Camden Maroney, guess who, on the tackle as well. Wildcats actually in that formation looking like a 3-5 look, a little overhang look. So it'll be a gain of about 2 or 3. It'll bring up second and long.
And we talked about last week against CHA just how good the defensive run stop really looked.
Yeah.
And
it's
kind of carried over to this week.
Which, like you said, in the pregame is going to come in handy against that crazy offense that Hinton runs and the same thing that Creston will try.
You're going to have to be able to stop the run against Hinton.
Four-man front here for the Wildcat defense. Keeper there by Douglas. Comes up. Camden Maroney with the trip. We want that one back, but there's enough to tackle him. Give credit to the sophomore. He falls forward, and it'll be third and manageable here. Again, 5:31, Wildcats up 14-0. Third and 4 from the 37, 38. Let's see what the Boomers do here. I got to believe probably most likely a jumbo set under center with Ace Long in the backfield. Let's see what happens here. Wildcats staying in that four-man front. Again, appreciate you guys joining us here on CWTV. Wildcats a little bounce back thus far here in the first quarter. Looks like it'll be a shotgun set, so see what happens here. Trips up top, ace down below is Taylen Laird. Max Brown lined up with him. Blitz showing. Cam Maroney up the middle. Finding his way through and weaving through will be a first down, and give credit to Ace Long. Nice patient run. It'll be a first down for the Boomers.
Yeah, that time brought Maroney kind of on a little inside blitz there, and just Woodward did a good job of blocking, stopping him from getting in there and making anything, blowing anything up in the backfield, and able to find a little bit of crease in that front line and get that first down. But Cashion Wildcats here making them work for every bit of it.
So clock running, 4:33, first quarter, first and 10 from the 44. In that same formation here now, trips on the short side here for the Boomers. Douglas, the sophomore in shotgun, back to pass, looking across the middle, going deep. Ball is floating. Cooper Frazee in, in, I guess, out there. It looks like it was a kind of a jump ball there over the shoulder. Intended receiver Lucas Shirky, the senior. I thought he had a chance out there.
Yeah, I did too for a second. I was waiting to see thinking her,
this ball is way overthrown. But he put so much air under it that the receiver was able to get there, and I think it bounced off his hands. I think Cooper was there to kind of break it up. But, yeah, pretty good pass there down the sideline.
I don't know if anybody saw on the pregame where our cameras were, but that last play they were warming up in was just like that. It just was up in the air like that.
Rainbow.
All right, so incompletion will stop the clock. 4:16 here, first quarter in shotgun against Douglas. Wildcat showing blitz. They'll bring the pressure on the outside. Jackson Vandruff trying to get around. They pledge. Coming up, Jake Branson initial there, and give credit to, looks like, Kai Gilbert on the tackle. Jake Branson in the vicinity as well, so that'll be a short gain. I'll bring up third down and long.
Yeah, that time, a good job by the guys out there to really turn him up. Had him in a position where if he made that, made Kai miss, he was going to be able to pick up some good yardage. Kai did a good job of breaking down and getting him down with only about a three-yard gain there.
So third and seven, 3:44, running clock here. Wildcats on defense, trying to get a stop and a ball back again. Trips left here, Douglas in shotgun. We've got Ace Long to the left of him this time. Let's see what power move here. They'll roll back to his left. Cotter in pursuit. Ball in the air, caught. Oh. Nice job in the zone there. Intended receiver is number 14, Mason Boring. And give credit to Douglas there. Found a spot. He had pressure. Yeah. Found the soft spot in the zone. And it'll be a first down for the Boomers.
Now, if you watch that play, we didn't have anybody blitz. We've been kind of bringing pressure. That time we just brought the four up front. Jackson was right there. Maybe it was Preston on this side.
Yep.
Was right there in his face, kind of jumping to try to knock it down because he knew he wasn't going to get there. Then we had Camden kind of fell back into coverage, and he jumped to try to knock it down. So give credit to that quarterback to kind of thread the needle there and find his receiver for the first down.
Wildcats four-man front looks like seven across. Handoff to Long. He's trying to get away from Matthew Stockton, but not after Jackson Vandruff gets him, and that'll be a short gain. It'll bring up second and 10.
Now, Matthew's doing a good job right there, kind of holding his own right there in the middle of the football field up in the front. That time he got squeezed through there and was able to kind of slow that running back down just enough for Jackson Vandruff to come in and clean him up from the backside.
That's what Casey Edgman would tell you. The best football players are wrestlers.
And that's what Matthew is. Yeah, that's right.
Stockton family, big wrestling family here in Cashion. So that's going to bring up second and 10, running clock 2:18 from the 43 on the Cashion side. Boomers moving the ball here, getting a couple of first downs. Douglas will keep it. He'll roll to his right in pursuit as Vandruff. Let's see if he can get the outside. Jake Branson trying to get there. Great speed there by the sophomore, and he'll get the first down.
Yeah, he just found the edge over there and was able to kind of turn on the Jets and get out there and pick up a big first down for the Boomers. They kind of got a little drive going here. Let's see if the Cashion Wildcats can stiff up and get a stop and not let them get into the end zone.
Really, situation just like we've seen earlier in the year. You know, I don't know why they would go away from the run, but they've gotten some good plays that have saved them on the pass, some good runs, and that's one of those things where, you know, our linebackers are going to be able to kind of get understand the speed now of the quarterback.
Take so better angles, yep.
1:33 running clock in motion is number 14, Mason Boring, handoff inside the long. He'll cut inside, got a nice lane. Eventually brought down, looks like Kai Gilbert as well as maybe Preston Cotter. And that'll bring up, that's a nice healthy chunk, 6 yards or 5 yards, bring up second and five.
Yeah, you said it. You know, there's been a lot of teams that we played this year that I feel like if they would just run the ball, keep going with that success of running the ball, that would have a better shot of really winning the ball game. Seems like teams get a little bit anxious or
a little impatient sometimes.
And they try to throw the ball, and then that's when it kind of gets them.
Keeper is Douglas that time. He had a good lane on the delay, and that will be another first down. So give credit to the Boomers. They found something that's working here. Let's see if Coach Wood changes something up. And you've said it. You know, we've taken off the blitz. It looks like I think Coach is maybe worried running our blitzer into the wrong gap, playing back a little bit flat. So it'll be first and 10. 31 seconds here in the first quarter. Wildcats up 14-0. Appreciate you guys joining us here at Cashion Wildcats TV. So we got 2x2 here as Douglas is in shotgun. To the right of him is number two, the freshman Ace Long in motion. This one will go to Long inside, gets the outside. Camden Maroney and Preston Cotter Actually, Jackson Vandross say no. And that'll be a short gain. That'll bring up second down and long.
Yeah, and that was Timmy Jones coming up there and really filling the gap with Preston Maroney. Preston Maroney.
Camden Maroney. Not Peyton Maroney either.
Not Peyton Maroney either.
Even he's next door.
Camden Maroney and really not giving them much of anything going there. And that's what you got to have when they get that running game going. The linebackers have to come downhill hard and fill those gaps and be able to really shut down what they've got going and punish the running back. Come downhill, and that's what the Cashion Wildcat defense has been known for over the last 4 or 5 years, is just punishing running backs. And by the end of the game, they don't want to stick their head back in that hole.
All right, so that'll be the end of the first quarter. Wildcats up 14-0. That was a 23-minute first quarter, Chris and Drew.
Well,
yeah, it was.
It could have been worse. It could have been longer. It could have been shorter. About right.
I don't know. It seemed like it was pretty fast.
Well, when you have a team like that that has run the ball a lot, we've gotten the ball and either scored or run the ball. You know, we kind of kept the clock running. That's what's going to happen. And you get into the playoffs and you start seeing teams that want to control the clock, that's when you start seeing 20-minute, 30-minute or less quarters. And, those games just seem like they fly by, and that's why every possession is big in a game like that. And that's why it's such a good position for the Cashion Wildcats to be in, being up two scores right now. If that's what they're gonna, if that's their game plan, is to try to run the ball, control it, control the clock. Being that we have two scores, two touchdown lead on them, that's going to come in big in the game.
Yeah, that was our Community State Bank kickoff kid there with.
I talked right through it.
All right, sounds good. Leah Harmon, we love our folks at Community State Bank. Drew, you wanted to say something?
No, I just had I know senior night's coming up on the 4th of November, I think it is, and Miss Broadman was kind enough to send me some of the other extracurricular activities that some of the senior boys do. We can sprinkle those in
spotlight here, senior spotlight here on CWTV. So Wildcats back out on defense, 12 minutes on the clock, second quarter, 2nd and 8, keeper is Douglas. He's going to work free. Camden Maroney eventually tackles him. He'll move forward, and he'll get a nice gain there on second down. It'll be third and manageable here for the Boomers.
Yeah, I feel like we're getting to him. It's just every time I look up, they've got 2 or 3 or 4 yard gains on those plays. We're going to have to get there, meet them in the hole, and have sure tackles. Don't let them keep those feet moving and pushing forward there.
Senior Camden, involved in golf, baseball, powerlifting, and FCA. So he's got all kinds of stuff going on. Seems like a busy schedule.
Yeah, Camden Maroney, number 61, as well as number 23, I believe, so on the season. So we love Camden. What a fantastic athlete altogether. Again, great athletic family. Keeper there by Ace Long, the freshman, trying to get the first down. The line holds, but it looks like they will get enough for the first down. The initial push was there. Looks like the Wildcats just lose it at the end, and give credit to Ace Long, the freshman, in the Wildcat formation. And that'll be first and goal from the 9-yard line.
And that's what I was talking about. I mean, we've got a good push and getting there. It seems like we're making contact. We're just not bringing them down behind the line of scrimmage like you've got to do when it's these running plays. If they get 3 or 4 yards of play, that's kind of what they want. That's working in their favor.
Yeah, like you said, Neem, it looked like we had it there for a second, and that last little give kind of pushed them right over the edge.
Now they're going back to Wildcat here. A little formation here with Ace Long, the freshman. He'll go ahead and keep it, run to his left. He's going to sprint out. Jackson Vandruff in pursuit. Give credit to Camden Maroney torpedoing him. And that'll be basically a gain of 1, 1.5, short 2 here. And that'll bring up 2nd and goal.
Yeah, they tried to get out there on the edge, get some blockers out there, and let the running back just try to find the seam. And Camden Maroney did what you have to do in those situations, is just come in flying as hard as you can. If you don't get to the running back, at least make a pile and slow him down. And that's exactly what he did there, and short game for the Boomers.
2nd and 7, 2nd and goal from the 7. Clock running, 9:58, 2nd quarter here. Again, power look here for the Boomers again, and Wildcat is number 2, the freshman, Ace Long. He's going to hand it off inside, and there's Preston Cotter, TFL. Hello. Nice work there by the defensive end, senior, coming in with a huge tackle and making it 3rd and goal.
Yeah, that time Preston just blows by his blocker, comes down the line and catches him from behind. And that time there was no getting those extra yards there. Preston had him wrapped up and down behind the line of scrimmage for a big tackle for loss there on 2nd down. Kind of backs them up where it's going to be 3rd and long with it being goal to goal.
That was Jeremy Bencomo, the freshman 5'8", 135 running back. He's back there again in essence, Wildcat with long. He'll roll to his left. No throw in motion. He's trying to get to the edge to see if he can. Being patient, will be pushed out of bounds. Good work in pursuit there by the Wildcats. Nice gain there, though, on third and long and third and goal. And that'll be a fourth down for the Wildcat defense. Let's see if they can hold here. Keep the Boomers out of the end zone.
And the Boomers, I mean, they've had more success out there on the edges. Let's see if they don't try to pull somebody, get them out on the edge, coming to this far side, and see if they can get to the corner before the Cashion Wildcats do. But with them calling timeout right here, Coach Wood's going to have that shirt up, and it's going to be a big play, fourth and goal for the Boomers.
So the Boomers starting on their own 30-yard line, chew up already. Looks like close to about 5 or 6 minutes at least here from the first quarter and the second quarter. They've worked it all the way down. It's fourth and goal. If you're Coach Wood, Drew, what's the story and situation here?
I think, like you said, Chris, he's probably just reassuring up, like, hey, here's your job. This is what we're going to do. Nobody calm. Like, you know, let's just calm down, make our reads, and just get where we're supposed to be.
All right, so the Wildcats have a chance here as the Boomers on their third possession. First one came up with a fumble on the first play. Second one, we're able to get a first down, but do throw an interception. And here on this third possession, they've gotten to work down. They've worked at 66 yards down on the 4 yard line. And let's see if Coach Wood and the bunch can figure this out. Wildcats going back out there, looks like with their base D. It'll be a four-man front for sure. And is it blitz time for the Wildcats, or do they try to seal off the edge again?
I mean, I think you just bring – I mean, the Boomers have been moving the ball well, and they've had some success. I say you take a gamble, try to get in there, meet them at the line of scrimmage and push them back, and we'll see what Coach Wood dialed up here.
All right, fourth and three. Long in Wildcat. He'll roll to his left again. Reverse, coming back through. And give credit. Great call there as Taylen Laird on the reverse, the senior 6'3", 175, gets the touchdown and cut into that Wildcat lead, 14-6.
Yeah, and that's something that we really haven't seen on film from them. I didn't see it. So give credit to the Boomers to pull that out of their hat. And we were kind of overcompensating. They just had a good play with that same kind of motion. And to bring that to Laird in that coming across for the reverse, it's caught the Cashion Wildcats off balance and was able to sneak in there for the Boomer touchdown.
So 70-yard drive is complete. Eats up about 7 minutes. Extra point is up. Left foot kicker. That's the second left foot kicker we've seen, isn't it?
Yep, I'm pretty sure that one went out to 74F out there. And that's what I said. And that's why I said I think they may score about 17 points because I'm just adding an extra field goal in there. They've got he's got a good enough leg. I was really wondering, you know, I think if it would have been a closer ball game, if we'd only been up by one score, we hadn't scored at all, they get to that point. I think they were close enough to the goal line that either way they're probably going to try to sneak it across the goal line. But if you stop them at the 10, 15-yard line and it's fourth down and, you know, five or so, they're going to break that kicker out here and try to sneak one in for a three-point.
All right, so give credit to the Boomers answering. Wildcats have been, you know, I don't want to say fortuitous. We've earned those plays, but Wildcats getting a couple of turnovers, turning those into points. On one of the drives, a high snap falls in the hands of Cooper Frazee, somehow gets a fourth down play into a first down, which could have been horrific for the Wildcats. So it'll be the Wildcats' chance to go back out on offense and respond. Kicking off for the Boomers, it looks like it will be, let me see if I can get this right,
Number 11.
Is it number 11? All right. Yep. So Lucas Shirky, the senior, 6'1", 165, wide receiver, DB. Deep for the Wildcats is Seth Gilbert and Max Brown. Wildcats will go with a 5-4-2 look here. It'll be a big kick. They're looking for Max Brown. Max will come up and catch on the fly off his helmet and go out of bounds. I don't have an excuse for you, Mr. Brown, but nonetheless, thankfully that goes out of bounds. It'll be Wildcat football, first and 10.
And maybe he had a headlight or you know, one of the stadium lights in his in his face or something. But
yes, lights got in his eyes. That was a high kick. But now bounces off his helmet, goes out of bounds. Cash and Wildcats will take over on their own 26-yard line. And I want to see the Cashion Wildcats come out here and keep doing what they're doing. I have a feeling that Shaq's going to try to run the ball some here. And then when he sees his shot, he's going to take a chance down the field.
Double tight end set for the Wildcats. Gilbert, Seth Gilbert on the right. Max Hickman, who had that last touchdown pass on the left. Little screen keeper, Acord. He's got a small hole. We'll move forward. He'll take a couple licks, and it looks like he'll pick up about 4 yards. So nice job there by Acord. Look like a designed draw.
I didn't know if that was design or a blown play there. Either way, pulled it down, got 4 yards.
We're going to say designed, yeah. Chris.
We'll say designed. Chance has done a great job all season for the most part. Of, you know, once he sees that kind of thing collapsing there, he's going to tuck the ball and just get a couple yards.
Max Brown shakes free on the screen and gets pushed out of bounds. Will it be enough for the first? It looks like it will. So give great job there by Max Brown. Individual play. Shaking off the tackle there. Number 10, Thomas Fairless, the sophomore.
Yeah, that time, you know, he threw it out there as a screen play. 10 does a good job of jumping it, getting by the blocker. But Max Brown does a great job of making him miss and picking up the first down.
Jumbo set here, Brown in the backfield with Higdon and Cooper. Frazee will get the handoff. He's got nowhere to go. Give credit to number 72, L.J. Mason, 6'3", 210, junior.
Yeah, he just throws Cheese. I think he was right there with Tommy and Cheese and just kind of throws them to the side and makes a big tackle in the backfield on Cooper.
So that's second and long now, second and 12, running clock 8:09 here, second quarter. Shotgun, Acord. Look over the sideline again. Double tight end set here. We've got Max Brown here on the short side. Cooper Frazee to the left of Acord. Snap. Back to pass. Come back to Brown. It's going to go off his hands. Or hand, duh. And the incompletion will stop the clock and it'll be third and long.
Yeah, that was just a kind of a high miss by Chance. You don't see that a lot from him. He's been pretty accurate all year long and gives his guys a shot to catch the ball that time. Just a little high and outside.
Wildcats go empty. I love this look here. Let's see if we can get a matchup that we like. We've got Brown and Frazee here on the short side. He's got he's drawn a couple. Blitz is on. Acord trying to get out of the pocket. He does. Going deep the outside. Ooh. And if Acord keeps and runs that, that's probably a first down. But he was looking for, looked like Seth Gilbert there on the sideline on the flag. That'll be incomplete. And it'll bring up fourth down. And the Cashion Wildcats will be punting for the first time tonight.
Yeah, as the pocket started to kind of collapse there, he did a good job.
Great job.
Pulling it down, yeah. And finding some space. And I'm with you, Nima. If he would have just kind of pulled that down and went to get as much as he could, if he didn't pick up the first down, it would have been close, and maybe gave the Cashion Wildcats a chance to go for it on fourth down.
Gilbert with the punt, layered deep in return. It's going to roll right by him. He's going to try to go get it. He'll let it go, and that'll be Barrick Wano with the grab there, and it'll be down right around the 29-yard line. So it'll be after the punt. So the Boomers will be taking over fourth possession. Scored on their last one. Let's see if the Cashion Wildcat defense can bow up here.
Yeah, Cashion Wildcat defense, if they let them do what they did in that last drive and just kind of run the ball.
Yeah, you're looking at 7 minutes of your clock burned up.
It'll be halftime with them down there by the goal line trying to tie it up. So the Cashion Wildcat defense has a big job here to, one, stop them, and two, not let them just run the clock dry in this second quarter.
All right, 7:35 on the clock, second quarter. Wildcats hanging on to a one-possession, one-touchdown lead, 14-7. Douglas in back. He'll go ahead and keep it roll right. Jake Branson will be there, and there's nowhere to go as Jake Branson's all over that one. That'll be a no gain for the Boomers.
Yeah, good job by Jake that time. You talked about the speed of the quarterback there early on, number 12, Ryan Douglas, and getting to the edge and making some big yardage. And you said, you know, those linebackers are going to learn from that and take better angles. That time, Jake did a great job, took a great angle, met him at the line of scrimmage, and was able to just drive him out of bounds for actually a loss of one on the game.
Yeah, a little TFL there for Jake Branson, second tackler, leading tackler on the season for the team. Second 11, 6:56 here. Again, shotgun look, 2x2 for Douglas in motion. Going to go ahead and get it on the screen, on the jet screen to Laird. He's got a big sideline.
Whoa.
Still on his feet. And Cooper Frazee eventually with the tackle, and give credit to number one, the 6'3", 175 wide receiver, and he gets it close to midfield.
Yeah, and I said, you know, that was one of my guys to watch, one of the players to watch for the Boomers. And I figured they would have already been trying to put the ball in his hands more than they have, and it shows you why right there. You know, you saw it on the touchdown. They had the reverse to him, He's an athletic kick and get out there, make a kid miss and get in the end zone. And you saw it right there on that jet sweep, just putting the ball in their best player's hands and letting him make some plays. And that time it was a big, big game for about, 15 yards?
Yep. So we'll have another timeout as Coach Lugin for the Boomers will use his second timeout, I believe. They have three on the board, but it looks like that is – I'm pretty sure that's their second.
Yeah, they took one earlier.
Yeah, it is.
We'll go ahead and take a timeout ourselves. Be right back. Wildcats up 14-7. Hang tight.
At Water Heater Man, we specialize in repairing and replacing all water heaters. We service the OKC Metro and surrounding towns with fast, reliable service. We keep our vans fully stocked with essential parts needed for basic repairs, and new tanks are always on the vans ready to go. We offer free estimates on all jobs with financing options available. We match manufacturer's warranty for all newly replaced water heaters. We'll get your water heater back up and running as fast as possible so you don't have to put your life on hold waiting for service. Give us a call today. 405-844-TANK. That's 405-844-8265. Go Wildcats!
Presenting Regatto Ranch. Located within the Cashion School District and offering homebuyers the experience of small-town charm with the modern world of shopping, dining, and healthcare just minutes away. Situated east of Highway 74, Regatto Ranch boasts one-acre home sites with privacy and ample space to retire or raise a family.
To build your next home from the ground up or to inquire about new property currently for sale, contact Brandon or Shannon Cotter with Iron Creek Homes and C7 Realty.
Come find your forever home at Regatto Ranch.
And go Wildcats!
For 31
years. Right, welcome back, CWTV, live from Maxon Field. Wildcats taking on the 4A Woodward Boomers. Boomers with the ball here near midfield. First and 10 off the jet sweep with Laird. Boomers will work back in that under center look underneath to the freshman. He's going to get a few yards, eventually brought down Tommy Branson. Give credit to Seth Gilbert, Kai Gilbert on the tackle, and it'll be a gain of about three. He'll bring up second down at seven as the freshman Ace Long gets another carry.
Yeah, you saw our front line kind of just cheated over there to this near side to kind of shore up the edge. And that time they tried to kind of take advantage of that opening. But Tommy Branson did a good job of just getting off his block, coming down the line and making a good tackle there for a short gain.
So 5:38, already a two-minute drive here for the Boomers, second quarter. Using the run game to take care of business, 2x2 in shotgun. Back to passes, Douglas Jackson Vandruff in pursuit. Douglas flips it out. Oh, Preston Cotter almost, and we'll have a flag with a legal man downfield. Has to be.
Yeah. I mean, the lineman was 15 yards down the field there, and that's got to be what it is. But I don't try to outguess.
There might be a defensive holding, possibly.
The only place in there where he could have thrown the flag was Preston Cotter trying to get to the ball. Really didn't see any. But maybe he was saying the running back was behind, or who he was throwing it to was behind the line of scrimmage, maybe?
No, it wasn't. He threw it at the stage. But that's possible. Yeah. I think that's a good point there. Nonetheless, flag is waved. It's picked up.
But great job by the officials coming together, talking it over, seeing what each other saw, and getting it right there for the officiating.
So the clock actually stops here. So that's a situation where Douglas, give credit to Jackson Vandruff, running basically 50 yards to chase him across the field. Third and 7, 5:16 on the clock. Wildcats need to stop here, maybe get a chance to get a score before halftime. They do get the ball at the start of the third quarter. Four-man front here for the Wildcats. Double tight end set. Wildcats show blitz. Timmy Jones, pressure Stockton. Deep ball. Max Brown against Laird. And that'll be a jump ball that falls incomplete. Excellent job by the back judge there. And that'll be an incompletion. Fourth down for the Boomers. Let's see what Coach Luchin does here. I can't believe he's punting.
Yeah, I mean, right here. They did the quarterback does a good job of scrambling, trying to find open receivers. And whenever he's throwing the ball in some of those where the receivers are just trying to find open spots, he delivers strikes. Yep. So I'm kind of with you.
Well, I wouldn't call it a strike. I would call it a more.
Well, I'm talking about the shorter passes first down. You know, if he was just going to try to find somebody in there for that 8 to 9 yard pass, but they are going to line up and punt it here.
So deep for the Wildcats is Seth Gilbert. Pressure is on. Punt's there. It's going to hit right around the 17. It'll die there right around the 16, 17, and it'll be Wildcat football first and 17. And that wasn't a slight to Douglas, but you guys mentioned he's throwing moon balls, right?
Yeah.
And you know what? I got to tell you, if you're looking for a guy named, you know, Talon Laird, 6'3", 175, that's not a bad target.
Yeah, no, not a bad target.
Ball to.
Well, that one there, you know, Max was there in good coverage. But you throw that ball up high for a kid like Laird to go up 6'3". Max is only right around maybe 6 foot.
Yep.
Yeah.
So you give that kid a chance with a jump ball, he's going to win it a lot of times.
Yeah.
I agree. Totally agree. 2x2 for the Wildcats. A-cord in shotgun. Looks like we've got Jake Branson now out here to the right, giving Cooper Frazee a chance to catch a breath. Actually, Cooper Frazee split out in the slot. A-cord back to pass. Coming back to Gilbert. Nice little find there on the dig. Gilbert will work it across the 30-yard line. That'll be a first down for the Wildcats.
Yeah, good job right there by Gilbert to just find that open spot and a chance to hit him and then just turn it upfield and go get what you can get. Enough for the first down.
Wildcats stay in that 2x2 formation. Branson the right of Acord in shotgun. Acord now will hand it off. Branson slips in the backfield, falls forward. It looks like it'll be a gain of about a third of a yard. It'll bring up second. Actually, you'll get the full yard. It'll be a third and second and nine here as Max Higdon checks in. Looks like Cooper Frazee will go back to running back. Wildcats will go to a tight end look here, a little 11 personnel. Brown aced out here. Let's see if we go, if the Wildcats go to him. Safety help over the middle, not on Max's side. Wildcats will have 10 seconds on the play clock. Clock running at 4:01. Frazee with the ball, nowhere to go. A little confusion there. And that'll be a loss of one or two, and it'll bring up third down and long.
Right there, you had Preston Cotter pulling through there. But before he could even get over there to really have that kick out block, you had one of the boomers kind of sneak through there and get to Cooper before he could get to the line of scrimmage.
Wildcats, third and long, screen. Actually, I apologize, the skinny post there, the slant, intended receiver was Max Brown. That one was a little over him, a little bit of contact,
yep.
Call. And Wildcats have fourth down, we'll have to punt.
Yeah, that time the defensive back was there in good coverage, kind of came through Max, but it was as the ball was getting there, so I mean, it could have kind of gone both ways.
Yeah.
There's no flag
I'm
there.
Not, yeah. I'm not asking for it.
Yeah, no flag there, and it brings up fourth down and long for the Cashion Wildcats.
Gilbert with the high punt. Laird will call for fair catch, and it'll be Woodward Boomer ball on the Woodward Boomer 40-yard line. And so with 3:26 here, Wildcats have gone back-to-back punts. Let's see if the defense can come back in and hold the Boomers before the half.
Yeah, both times that the Cashion Wildcats have been really backed up on their side of the field, we just haven't been able to get anything going. You know, we had the big long run there by, I think, Kai Gilbert after he caught the ball from Chance. Other than that, just nothing. We couldn't get anything running game established, and it really hurts that passing offense when you don't have any kind of run game to kind of throw that defense off balance a little bit.
All right, so first and 10, Wildcats back out on defense again, that four-man front. Look at a 4-5 look here. I'm not sure. Actually, no safeties. Let's call it 4-7 across. Douglas back to pass. We'll have a flag. Vandriff chasing him in pursuit. Coming up, Branson. He'll throw it away out of bounds. Let's see what the flag is for as it goes incomplete.
It's got to be an illegal motion or illegal procedure or something there that they didn't stop it on before the play started. It will be an illegal procedure, looks like.
Drew, is this a situation where Coach Shaq starts using his timeouts to try to get one more shot here before half? Or?
It wouldn't surprise me if he does, but I really think just us getting the ball in the second half, we're probably just going to try and shore things up and just.
Well, it depends on kind of where the ball is on the field, I think. You know, if they have a big play, get down the field, you don't see Shaq use them at all, I don't think.
Yeah, I don't either.
You get them backed up here with the opportunity to get the ball back where they're in long, you know, if they get
so like
long,
field position, we have a good field position to maybe
so
take
what is
a
Coach,
shot.
So knowing that, what does Coach Luchin do here? Does he?
I'm surprised he hasn't done one of those quick passes like he did to what was it Laird, the 6'3" kid? I thought
sweep,
that little jet sweep play that they did there in the second quarter was really good for them.
So with the mark off of 5 yards, it'll be a repeat of first down. We're watching the box, making sure we understand. And big credit so far. You said it. I really absolutely love this group here, this group of officials.
Somebody had their headlights on. They were trying to get them off before we started. I couldn't figure out what was the holdup.
Tailgating and cashing. Right. All right, so first and 15, 3:19 on the clock for the Wildcats here on defense. From the 35, the Boomers will go trips right. Douglas, the sophomore in shotgun. He's got Ace Long to the left of him. He's going to go for the slant for Laird. Slips past Maroney, still on his feet. Good catch. And that'll be a first down for the Boomers. In Cashion territory.
That's kind of what I was wondering. You know, when are you going to give that kid a shot on something to just get him in position with the ball in his hands? And they've tried to throw it long to him, but really, other than that, the only time that he's had the ball in his hands was, you know, the jet sweep and the reverse. And give him a chance to make a move, get open, and get the ball in his hands. If I'm the Boomer fan or Boomer coach, that's who I'm trying to get him and get him the ball.
2:42. Second quarter. Wildcats trying to get a stop here. Back to pass again. Vandruff across the middle, up top. Lair, the intended receiver, goes up over Brown, makes a catch, and that's two in a row. And that's deep in Cash and Wildcat territory, right around the 31.
That's that same play you were talking about earlier, Chris, on the last possession. You know, if Max Brown's going up against someone that's 6'3", it's kind of you never know how it's going to shake out, and that was just a great example of that.
So is this a situation where we just double up on number one?
I would. I just kind of
got to bracket him.
Bracket him, but you don't want to take away from stopping that run. I mean, they got a good enough run game that's why it's important to establish the run game. You establish the run game, it's kind of hard to do. But in this situation where you got 2 minutes left on the clock and they're throwing the ball down the field, put two on him and try to get one intercepted.
The first and 10 from the 31, cash inside. Douglas with a swing pass outside. He's got a blocker. The receiver there is number 14, Mason Boring, the sophomore. I believe that's his second catch of the night. And he'll go out of bounds. That'll stop the clock, I believe. And that'll be a big pickup on first down. It'll bring him second down in about three or four.
Yeah, Preston Cotter did a good job of getting up the field. Almost had a hand on that to knock it down. But just sneaks right by him for the completed pass and the pickup of about 8 yards.
All right, so the Boomers driving. Started with the ball with 3:26, 1:51 stop clock here, second and four from the 25. They started on their own 40 after getting a punt after a three and out by the Wildcat offense. Back to pass again is Douglas. He's going to pump. He's going to go deep. Intended receiver number 13, Carson Medina. It looks like it is picked off.
Nope, he caught it.
Oh. So Medina grabs it, battling it out with Kai Gilbert. And the Boomers score and get it within one.
And that's one of those balls that it was just floated up there so high that the Woodward receiver was able to turn around and really make a better play than the Cashion defender. Kai just couldn't, he didn't know where the ball was. He was in a good spot, but he wasn't able to go up and high point the ball like the Boomer receiver was there. And he was able to come down with it in the end zone for the Boomer touchdown.
Extra point is up, and it's good. And we've got a tie ball game. So with 1:43 left here in the second quarter, it was a 60-yard drive that lasted actually a paltry 2 minutes.
And that's the thing. I almost said, well, they scored too quick. I mean, the Boomers are thinking, let's just get in the end zone no matter how quick we do it. But that does leave, a minute 43 on the clock before halftime with Cashion with the ball in their hands to try to go down and get that lead back and then get the ball coming out of halftime.
All right, so Wildcats will have a chance here to answer all three timeouts. Back to in return will be Max Brown and Seth Gilbert. Brown, the recipient of the last two kickoffs, the last one coming off his face mask and going out of bounds. Let's see if kicker number 11, Lucas Shirky, I believe it was 11, or was it 14, Mason Boring? No, it was number 11.
11.
Lucas Sharkey, number 11, senior, 6'1", 165, wide receiver. So what started off as a fast, great start for the Wildcats at 14-0 in the first quarter has been nothing in the second quarter, and it's been the Boomers on back-to-back who are actually scoring on the last two of their three drives.
Well, it was kind of flip-flop, that first quarter. Cash and Wildcats, every time they touched the ball, it was just gold. Went to the score get to the end zone. The Boomers weren't able to move the ball at all in that first quarter. And then you get to the second quarter, and the Boomers were able to just do pretty much anything they wanted to on the offensive side of the ball. And Cashion just can't get anything going. any momentum on the offensive side, and it all depends on this first down play right here, how the Cashion Wildcats fare. It seems like it's gone that way all season long. You have a good first down play. The Cashion Wildcats kind of has an open up playbook, and you can kind of have a little bit more success. You get behind the chains on first down, and it's just kind of your hands are tied. So let's see what the Cashion Wildcats do here on first down. It's a big play.
Hey, quarterback to pass, looking for Brown. He's going to go deep. Ace Stout, he's beating his man. Caught the ball to 30, 25, big time pass and catch. Max Brown from Chase Acord, and my man Chris Gibson is a soothsayer.
Hey, big play on first down right there. Gets the Cashion Wildcats with a minute and 30 seconds left on the clock, all the way down to the Boomer 23-yard line with a great opportunity here going in half.
Brown beats Fairless out on the outside. He'll go ahead and keep it now. Acord will run the outside. He's got a small lane to the outside, to the 15, cuts it back up. Keep running, son. He'll cut up, and that'll be another first down for the Wildcats, as the Wildcats moving all three timeouts here. Let's see if Coach Shaq does take one of them. So nice response here for the Wildcats. Two plays under 20 seconds, eating up about 60 yards.
Yeah, great job right there by Chance. It kind of faked me out. I thought he had given the ball to Cooper Frazee. Frazee gets hit, and then I see Chance just scoot around
the outside.
Yeah, does a great job there to get the Cashion Wildcat first down. Shaq does take the timeout with a minute and 13 seconds left to get the kids over here and just say, hey, we're in a perfect position here to go up a touchdown going into this halftime and then come back out here with the ball out of the second half. Let's concentrate. Let's get our wits together and get out here and have a big play. Well, let's see if we don't have a shot at the end zone this very first play just to get them get in the end zone. But down here with a minute and 13 seconds left, do you try to run the ball, eat a little bit of clock before you get in the end zone? Either way, the Cashion Wildcats need to get in this end zone to take that lead back right before halftime.
All right, so 1:13 here, Wildcats first and 10 from the 11. They'll get a first down at the 1 yard line if needed. They're going to come out with Jumbo with Kai Gilbert and Max Higdon at tight end. Cooper Frazee in the backfield with Chance Acord. Doubled up here on the short side with on the boundary field side with Max Brown and Kai Gilbert. Look to his left, back cross, and he's going to throw it away across the line of scrimmage.
They're going to call. They're probably going to call. They are grounding here because he didn't get outside the tackle box there.
He did not, and I think some of those Woodward fans are asking for it. They will drop the flag. So, a situation, a new rule in high school football here in Oklahoma is that in years past, you just had to get it across the line of scrimmage. Now you got to get outside the tackle, just like you're used to in college and pro. That's a big mistake here for the Wildcats who were driving.
Yeah, because that's going to be at the spot of the throw, and it's going to be loss of down. So it's going to be second down and about 16 here. And so Cashion Wildcats backed up a little bit, but still in a great position here to have a chance to get in the end zone. Oh, it is a 5-yard penalty from the spot of the foul, I guess.
Yep, that's what it looks like. So I think that the officials are talking it over. And you know, this is one of the situations you don't want to second-guess Shaq on the timeout. I was kind of wanting to keep going, hurry up. We had them on their heels. And that will be another mark-off. So you're exactly right, partner. So it is from the spot of, I guess, where he threw the ball.
Yeah.
And all he had to do was get outside the pocket. He did get it across the line of scrimmage. So big-time loss, second and 20, a loss of 10 on that play. Back to pass, Acord will pump. He'll step up in the pocket. Slant is there. Brown, touchdown. It doesn't matter, the Wildcats. 20-yard pitch and catch. Max Brown to the house.
And I had it on the field view. I hope that you were able to see that. Great job by Chance there to step up in the pocket and kind of collapsed early. He stepped up in the pocket and just threw a strike to Max Brown. Then Max Brown caught it about the 5-yard line with somebody on his back and was able to just kind of carry them into the end zone for the big Cashion Wildcat touchdown right here before halftime. Go into the halftime with the lead, and then you're getting the ball with the kickoff as you come out of the locker room. Great job of the Cashion Wildcats to take advantage of the time they had left on the clock right here before halftime.
So the Wildcats got it with 1:38. They took him just four plays with the penalty to punch it in. They go 68 yards and take the lead 20-14. We still don't have the points on the scoreboard, but we're pretty sure that they counted. We do have an injured player on the field as a Boomer
out around the 5-yard line on that last play. I don't know if you have an instant replay or not on
this. I'm going to try to pull up. I screwed up and went to the field cam and didn't go back. If anybody's out there watching, they have the dream of producing high school football.
Come on out.
We'll take you in a second. Oh, that's where they marked it off. So it'll be back up here in just a second. But I might have it after the field, the extra point here.
So the Wildcats will try to not get that extra point. Again, freshman Brian and Bobby on the hold. Chandler Christensen on the kick, number 6. Another Christensen with that golden boot.
Keeping the kicker tradition alive and well.
We have another Christensen to come up, so we'll see what happens there. Snap, hold, kick is up. It's a beaut, and it's good. Wildcats up a score, 21-14.
Yeah, here's the replay. I hope you can see it. Watch Chance with the ball. You got it. And kind of had some pressure, steps up, and just delivers a strike to Max Brown. You can see it. Yeah, nice.
Great job, Gage.
Yeah, good job by the boys down on the field to catch that. Good job right there. Like I said, for the Cashion Wildcat offense, they had struggled the two possessions right before that. Yep. To have the ball with a minute and 30 seconds left and have to drive, you know, the length of the field to try to score right before halftime, man, that was a huge opportunity for the Wildcats to get the ball with that much time left in the half, and then they took advantage, drove right down the field. Now, 58 seconds left, the Boomers kind of aired it out that last possession. Yep. So now it's the time for the defensive backs to really step up and come away with a big interception here.
They have one timeout. All right, so appreciate you guys hanging tight with us. A lot of fireworks here in the second quarter. Wildcats, again, just using just a little bit of clock. Big pass from Acord to Max Brown on first down, going 50 yards, kind of setting it all up. Another 10-yard run by Acord. And then the penalty and the throw. Wildcats end up high onside. That one's going to go out of bounds.
Come on, Kale. Catch the ball, man. And
we'll have a penalty there that'll give the ball to the Boomers right around the 35 or 40-yard line. We'll see where the markoff is. It'll be first and 10, so it's defense time. Chance to get another turnover?
Hey, that's what I'm saying. They're going to try to air it out. I mean, they had success throwing the ball that last drive. I don't see why they wouldn't try to air it out and try to get in the end zone with a minute left and a timeout. And so knowing that as a defensive back, you're licking your chops saying, throw it over here to me. I'm going to go up and try to get an interception. And
so maybe we might see some pass to Laird.
Yeah, no doubt. They're going to try to air it out to Laird and let him go up and get some. We said the quarterback has a rainbow. I mean, it's been on the money, but as a defensive back, I'm looking at it as an opportunity to go up and get an interception. Looks like they're going to re-kick this here.
Looks like they're going to take the penalty. Marcus back, so I guess they don't have trust that Chandler can boot one. And you know what? I like the call. If I'm coach here, you know what? It's going to put pressure on us. He feels like he's got a playmaker, a number one, and Laird. Wildcats over.
So the option, tell me this. So when you kick it out of bounds like that, you either have the option of taking it at the 35-yard line or having them re-kick?
From the 35 with a mark off. So they mark it off. So they go back 5. So instead of kicking from the 40, Christensen will be kicking from the 35.
So there's an option on that.
Yes, absolutely. And okay. I like this. So, you know, knowing Wildcat tendencies, right? So they say, hey, you know what? We're going to stick our best guy out there. Let's see what happens. Looks like we've got Vandruff and Jake Branson out there on that right side. We're going to go middle kick. It's going to go.
That's a great kick right there.
It's going to go hit right at the 20. It's going to roll. Laird will get it. Jackson Vandruff's in the vicinity. He's going to get right by him, but he won't get past him.
And that's took it, yeah.
That's a great job by the Cashion Wildcats here. Great job by Christensen kicking that open space in the open zone. It bounces Laird with a limited return.
He kind of cut it back right into Jackson right there. I was like, yeah, that's done as soon as Jackson gets a hold of you.
Yeah, I mean, Christensen, you know, he did a great job just kind of kicking a line drive to where the opening was on the field, and Laird couldn't get to it before it hit the ground, and it scooted. If they would have taken just the penalty off the kickoff, they'd have been at the 35-yard line. Now they're backed up all the way to about the 28,
and they also lost a few seconds there. Yep. So with 49 seconds left, it's first and 10 here for the Boomers. They're going to go in that same shotgun formation, back to pass.
Douglas is going to flip it out. He's got a wide open receiver, number 14, Gump out there in coverage. He'll sling him down. That was a bust in coverage as Gump had number 11, Lucas Shirky, going deep. That's a big pitch and catch.
Yeah, right there, I'm thinking where that ball was, is that that's probably one of the linebackers need to be there.
So with a spike there, Tommy Branson coming up. And so
Tommy thought that was a fumble.
Yeah, Tommy was ready.
He spiked it on. Yes, he's thinking, let me have the ball.
I say go get it too, Tommy. I'm with you, Tommy. So that'll stop the ball with 33 seconds. So that was a nice play there by the Boomers to get it up near midfield.
Here's where the kicker comes in play. Yep. You get it up here to about the 30-yard line. Yep. This kid's got a leg on him enough to probably kick a 40-yarder. So he gets to the 30-yard line, gets him to, 25-yard line. They have an opportunity to kick about a 40-yarder and get three on the board right before half.
Well, you better be quiet. So trips up top, 32 seconds, running clock. Douglas flips it out. It's got his open man, Laird. I'm not even sure how he gets open. Max Brown eventually with the tackle. And that is a horrific matchup if Kendon Maroney is matched up with Taylen Laird.
Yeah.
Yeah, no doubt. And that's give credit to the Boomers. I guess the way they lined up there had him in that position. And they found him open. But the little sophomore quarterback, yep, is shifty, can, yep, get out there, and, yep, he can, yep, throw the ball on,
well,
the run.
He's shown he's throwing those rainbows, but he's throwing some nice passes, yep, here. So you're right, give him credit. So with 14 seconds left from the 27, Wildcats will take they'll take it. Looks like who's going to take the timeout here?
Woodward.
Timeout Woodward. So that's going to be their last timeout as the clock did stop for the chains, but we'll roll. So instead of taking the spike, Coach Luton goes ahead and calls the timeout here.
Yeah, and you know what, I figured he would try to spike it, get, you know, be second and 10, try to take a few shots down the field. And where they're at right now, I'm telling you, the kid's got a leg on him enough to give the Boomers a shot at a field goal here. But what he's thinking maybe is, I'm going to take my shot down the field, and then if we don't get it, kick it with, you know, 5 seconds on the clock. But in high school, it's hard to really run that crew out there. You only got 14 seconds on the clock. So if he doesn't get in the end zone there, it's going to be almost the end of the half.
Yep. All right, we got some Perkins Tryon football players here to check out, I guess, a little Woodward. A little scouting here. We got scouting on all sides. I see a Ben Harmon, Nick Nabavi scouting as well.
If I'm hitting, I'd have been here. I'd have been here tonight if I was hitting.
Yeah. And they may be in the end zone.
But they may be also thinking, we got a big game against Minko tomorrow.
Yep. Right.
And we don't need to be out traveling, watching some other team that we aren't even facing
Chris,
this week.
Chris bringing you full circle. All right, so with 14 seconds, first and 10 from the 27. This has been the formation here the last couple series here for the Boomers. And again, give credit to sophomore Ryan Douglas, 5'6", 135, throwing some rockets now, some true fastballs, finding his man Taylen Laird, also number 13 Carson Medina, Mason Boring, and Lucas Sharkey. So back in shotgun is Douglas. He's got Ace Long next to him. Back to pass on the screen, coming out. Gump fights through the blocking, and he'll make the tackle. Give credit to the sophomore.
And they're going to keep the clock running.
They will.
So that's going to be the end of the half right there, because there's no way they're going to be able to get up and lined up before the
Well, they get the spike, and they have no time. So that'll be it.
That'll be it.
So with that, great job, Gump. Not only did he make the tackle, they're going to talk it over here.
They're saying 1 second, so I guarantee they're going to line up and try to let this kid boot one. And I was watching the clock, and I didn't have wasn't able to kind of line it up. The umpire there is in perfect position to watch that ball being spiked and the clock. So I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt there for leaving him 1 second. But it is going to be a what is that going to be, about a 30 or 40, what, 45-yard field goal.
All right, Wildcats staying deep. Snap, hold, kick is up. It's got some distance, and it's going to be short. No good. So very close.
I told you that Duke.
He had the line.
Yeah.
He had the line, but that one falls short. That would have been a 45-yarder, but it falls short. So the Wildcats hang tight, get a stop, and we head to halftime as the Wildcats are up 21-14 against the 4A Boomers. Hang tight with this. We've got band and cheerleaders. We're not going to go away to commercials just yet, but we'll take a break here off the mic, and we'll bring it back here in a sec here on CWTV.
Cashion fans, please welcome your Cashion High School cheer squad.
Here's in counting, Community State Bank has taken great pride in being your hometown bank. With branches located in Cashion, Dover, and Hennessy, CSB strives to reflect the small-town hospitality these communities are known for. Our friendly staff is here to serve you and provide one of the best banking experiences around, equipping our customers with the latest in banking technology combined with a personal, down-home relationship. Come into one of our local branches or visit us at www.mycsb.com. Community State Bank, small-town banking, the way it should be. Member FDIC.
Support your school's Booster Club and get your business in front of thousands of potential customers.
Talk about a win-win.
Advertising packages start on this streaming station for less than $10 a game. Call 405-726-0835 or email adam@squirtle.com right now for more information.
Cashion FBC.
Ladies and gentlemen, for your halftime entertainment, please welcome the Pride of Cashion as they perform Louie Louie, the classic by Richard Berry and the Pharaohs, followed by Smash Mouth All-Star and Chicago's hit song 25 or 6 to 4.
down, dumbass. You can't go down, dumbass. I can't. Yeah, I know. It's long down.
Boom. All right, we're back from the halftime performance of the Cashion Band. They were kind of killing it out there.
Yeah. Dagan Lloyd, football player by day. band player by night.
Matthew Stockton, football player by day, tuba player at halftime.
That is small town football right there.
Yeah, that's good stuff right there. But so what's your thoughts on the first half?
Oh, I
would ask you about the CHA game, but we'd be here for the whole rest of the half.
I don't know that Woodward's in such a tough spot. You know, and Woodward's had some they've had some players in the past. They've been good at times, but they're not quite that this year. They're struggling. That quarterback is a little bitty guy.
Yeah,
he's got some wheels on him, man.
Yeah,
and an arm.
Well, so their starting quarterback, I think, broke his leg 2 weeks ago. So that's why one that's in now, he's a sophomore, I think. So he's only had 2 weeks to kind of roll into that.
I mean, he's not real big, but man, he runs the ball pretty well, and we're playing better. Last week was the first time that we played all year long that we looked like a football team. I was really impressed.
Yeah, I thought especially defensively, when we were able just to stop their run and really kind of hold them, I was really impressed with that. I wish we could have stopped the run a little bit better in the second quarter here. But if I'm Coach Lugit from Woodward, I'm throwing it to that number 11 kid the time.
I'm throwing it to one as well. They're shooting a gun, a shirt gun. They ball up a shirt and shoot it into the crowd. They're going to kill somebody.
It looks like it's coming out of a mortar tube.
Yeah. Oh, it is. It looks dangerous. I don't know. I think that we're getting better every week. That Chance?
Chance Accord.
Yeah, Chance
Accord.
He has got so much arm talent. He could throw that ball so easily. He made three or four great passes tonight, and he looks really, really good. You know, we've had some kids that we've got a kid that's got a broken foot. Looks like.
Yeah, one of the linemen's got a broken foot or a messed up foot. They said he might be able to be back for the Hinton game. And then Nathan DeBobby's out with a concussion. I'm not sure if it's for a good long duration or if it's just for the next game or so.
Right.
And then, I mean, of course, that is little guys that you have. Then you got to move Candon around. You got to move some other guys around. So it just kind of took away from our running offense a little bit, because then you had Camden, Max, and Nathan, and they could all do things a little bit differently. And so now you're kind of limited there on what you can do.
But we look all right tonight. I'm liking the way that we're looking there better and better every week. The thing that we really don't want to happen, if we finish fourth in our district, who do we play?
I believe it'd be Ringling. You want to play Ringling?
At Ringling.
At Ringling.
That's something we don't really want to take part in, I don't think.
Which we kind of talked about it in the pregame. How does it have to look? I mean, we got to win out at this point, isn't it?
Right.
Got to beat Hinton and Crescent.
And I don't.
Does it matter anyway if Hinton, let's say Hinton loses to Minko tomorrow? Does that affect anything?
I think if Hinton beats Minko, it would be better for us.
Pull up our district stats real quick.
So,
yeah, so I mean, Crescent's undefeated in the district. In second place, Christian Heritage 3-1. Third place, Minko 2-1, and us in fourth right now 1-2. So you've got Hinton, who's 0-2 in the district, and Matonga, who's 0-3 in the district.
So if we beat Hinton and Crescent, and if Minko gets beat by, who does Minko have left?
Hinton. Minko and Hinton still have to play.
Yeah, and then Minko plays Watonga. Anyway, I don't know. That whole thing confuses me.
But still, I mean, like Shaq mentioned before the game, you know, this team's got some size to him. That's what kind of Crescent and the Hinton deal was going to look like the next 2 weeks.
Right.
They're going to have some size, and they're going to be able to try and run the ball. And Hinton runs that crazy, crazy offense that we just never see until, you know, you play Hinton, or like Morrison used to do something kind of similar like that. So that's just, I mean, I don't know how you translate and prepare for that in a different way.
The thing that I love about what Shaq does, Shaq's not afraid to play anybody. And he told them kids tonight, he's like, we have nothing to lose here. We're playing a team that's a lot bigger than us, that should beat us, is probably faster than us, probably stronger than us. But we've been a lot more big stuff than they have. And so it's a way to kind of prove ourselves. And I think that when we have games like this, it gives us a lot more confidence.
I think when we were talking about the Minko game, then next week we play Western Heights. Is this the difference between the Minko game, Western Heights game, and then the CHA game? How much better and we looked, how much more confident we looked, was really obvious.
And we've seen these teams in the past, you know, Gore's especially is one that sticks out. They're undefeated going into the playoffs and they get beat first or second round because they're not playing anybody of any significance out there. So I kind of like the way our schedule's stacking up right now.
Which, I mean, you look, talking about people that really don't play anybody till kind of like the playoffs deal, you look at like Winniewood, Ringling, and you're like, oh, they're kicking everybody's butt going in through the season. And you're like, okay, like who have they really played that's going to give them some competition? Versus us, we've always got two or three people on our schedule every year that are either a class or two classes above us that actually have some real athletes on their team.
Right.
So as far as stats go, who's got the best looking stats going into the half?
The thing that that's a backbreaker for Woodward is we scored there with, you know, 30 seconds left. Now we get the ball second half. So we get up on them 28. You know, if we score, we go up on 28-14. It's going to make it a lot tougher for them to kind of get back.
Do you think they have to change their offense up a little bit? You know, they were kind of burning. I mean, I think in the second and first quarter, they burned like 9 minutes off the clock with just their first possession.
Oh, I think they keep on doing what they've done. I think they're in pretty good shape as far as they move the ball. They just have a couple plays there that they just look kind of poor. Cooper Fraser's got 9 carries for 24 yards. Chance is 2 carries for 15 yards. You know, he had a couple plays where he could have run it. He threw it away. He could have had more yardage on running the ball. Max Brown's got 5 catches for 93 yards. That was a heck of a pass.
Great pass.
Chance is 8 of 11 for 150. So nothing's jumping off the chart on you. You know, our defensive stuff, Camden Maroney still is a playmaker. I tell you, Jake Branson's really stepped up the last 2 or 3 weeks. He's really, really played well. A lot of tackles. And in the last 2 or 3, 4 years, we've had some kids, younger freshmen, sophomores, juniors that led the team in tackles and were up and comers. Man, we've got a lot of heavy stack seniors. Camden Maroney, Jake Branson, Kai Gilbert, Jackson Vander, Preston Cotter. They're the top 5 leading tacklers. And Carson Gump's got 2 tackles. He looked good. That tackle he made towards the end of the half he looked really, really good.
And they all do a bunch of stuff. We kind of were trying to read it as we were going into the second half there, but like Jake Branson does track, Stuco, Max, golf, basketball, NHS, mentor, Preston, baseball, golf, mentor, FCA, NHS, Seth and Kai, Stuco and FCA, Camden, golf, baseball, powerlifting, FCA, Jackson, basketball, track, powerlifting, NHS, FCA, mentor, and then all of them also have over a 3.0 GPA. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, they're doing all kinds of stuff.
And, you know, this game is a lot of fun to watch just because we're playing against a much bigger school. You know, you've been through Woodward before. You can see how big that town is.
Yeah, I mean, we're playing a town with a Walmart.
And a McDonald's and a Brahms, you know, on and on and on. The next 2 weeks after this is really going to be where the future of our team is going to be made. It's a make or break here. We're going to have to win at least one of the two to make the playoffs. And so, like we talked earlier, it's hard to decipher everything on how the thing is going to shake out. I wish we had that Christian Heritage game back. I wish we had that Minko game back.
The Minko game and the CHA game.
That Minko game we let get away from us, that we were a lot better than what we played. Minko may have beat us, but they weren't 28-7 better than us.
No, and same thing with the CHA game. I think you play that again and just some little things go a little bit different way. It might be, and who knows, you may not win that game, but I don't think it ends the way that it kind of ends there. But, I mean, you know, it is what it is. You can go back and play the what-if game all the time. I'd like to play Afton a couple times, but I think we would have lost to them both those times. And I think they'd agree with us. Yeah. But
the fighting Christians beat us last week, and I wish we could play them one more time. But we can't. Huh?
Playing one more time.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's definitely a theme
this
year.
We had some old men come up earlier, talk to us. Nick.
Yeah, Nick was here. Nabavi,
Nicky the Sticky was here.
Ben Harmon.
Binion Harmon was here.
Binion Harmon was here.
So they look old, don't they? Look like wasted old men.
Wasted old men. They're withered away.
I know.
But I think with that, we've only got about a minute left before they're going to come back out
they
and start
like
really warming up.
They look like they're trying to hold on to life. It looks like they just, I don't know, they just don't look good.
So you're...
Jared,
you all know Jared Kraken?
Yes.
Do you know this Fish Boys? Are you familiar with this Fish Boys?
Yeah.
But we've got about a minute left, and we'll take it to a quick commercial break. But that's Lessons with Lane at halftime there, and we'll be right back this.
All right.
C is a church seeking to grow in Christ and our love for the body of Christ. With ministries from children to youth to adults, we strive to present the gospel in an engaging and meaningful way. Sunday school meets at 9:45 a.m., and worship starts at 11 a.m. Children and youth meet on Wednesdays at 6 p.m. Please check our website at cashionfbc.org for more information, and we hope to see you this Sunday, located a half mile east of Cashion.
Oklahoma Career Tech's been serving up skills for doers just like you for over 100 years.
But this ain't your great Grammys and pop-pop tech school.
Oklahoma's favorite place to learn new skills keeps learning new tricks. Everyone knows the best way to learn is to do it yourself.
Sir, you okay?
Because you shouldn't have to wait to do what you love. Whatever you choose to do, do you.
Oklahoma Career Tech.
Absolute Pools, Lawns, and Landscape is not your ordinary pool builder. From traditional to exotic and anything in between, our staff offers paramount quality and service through the entire design and build process. We provide service to the entire OKC metro and surrounding towns. So relax, knowing our team is wholeheartedly committed to building a trusting and lasting relationship with you. Visit us on Facebook or give us a call today at 405-285-9729. Absolute Pools, Lawns, and Landscape.
All right, welcome back. Cashion Wildcats TV, broadcasting live from Maxon Field, where your Cashion Wildcats taking on the 4A Woodward Boomers. Neiman Abavi, Chris Gibson, and my man Drew Baker bringing you tonight's our second half action here, about to start here in about a couple minutes. Had Lessons with Lane with Drew. Hopefully you guys enjoyed that. Also, halftime performances by the cheer team as well as the band.
Dude, Neiman and I were standing outside the press box watching the band, just enjoying. That was a great job by the band. The 7th and 8th grade out there with the high school.
I love it.
Getting after it.
Totally agree. They did a little Chicago. I loved it. Wildcats up 21-14. Again, Wildcats with 9 first downs to Woodward's 11. Total yards in favor of Woodward, 209 to 190.
And I saw that stat right there, and I was just like, wow, I can't believe Woodward has more yards than we do. I was thinking we had more than that, but you got to think that second drive, we had pretty good field position.
Yeah, yeah. 42 and the 43 of Woodward.
Yeah, and then those two drives that we didn't score on, we didn't move the ball at all. Yeah. So that's kind of the difference there.
Yeah, absolutely. Only one, actually two turnovers in the game, and those both going against the Woodward Bombers. A fumble on the very first play of the game, and first play of the offensive series of the game, and then an interception on the second series, both leading to touchdowns for the Wildcats. Cooper Frazee with a two-yard touchdown on the first one. Max Higdon with his first catch and first score of the season, his varsity career, with a 43-yard touchdown pass across the middle. Wildcats don't get in the end zone until their fifth possession with 1:38 left on the clock. They're able to get a 20-yard touchdown from Max Brown. Chance Acord. Wildcats, again, leading the only passer of the night, Chance Acord, 8 for 11, 150 yards long, a 45. That one, I guess, to Max Higdon. We'll get that at 45 yards. Two touchdowns, no interceptions. Cooper Frazee, leading rusher, 24 yards. For him on 9 rushes, he does have 1 touchdown. Chance Acord, the second leading rusher, 15 yards, averaging around 7.5 a carry. And then receiving, Max Brown with almost 100 yards in the first half. 93 yards, 45 on his long there, 7 targets for 5 catches and a touchdown. And Max Higdon again with that other touchdown. So Wildcats will be receiving.
Keys to the game for me was rush, get that rush game going. We only have 40 yards rushing. I think if we're going to be able to win this ball game, we're going to have more than 40 yards in the second half on the ground, and keep really being able to keep throwing that ball down the field like we have in that first half.
All right. Receiving deep is Max Brown. He's received all kickoffs. He'll get this one. He'll catch this one right at the 20.
Take it.
Taking his chance. He'll cut back out. Breaks two tackles. Eventually tackled right around the 35, where the Wildcats will take over. First down and 10.
Yeah, that time That kicker does a good job of getting it really high in the air and gives his return team a chance to get down and cover. Max just could not get anything really rolling there. Gets it out to the 35-yard line. Better field position than we've had a few times in that first half. And it's a big possession here for the Cashion Wildcats to go up again two possessions.
2x2 for the Wildcats. Cooper Frazee to the right of Acord. Back to pass as Acord looks to his right across the middle. Got Cooper Frazee on the out right around the 40-yard line. It'll be a gain of 5.
So I like that right there.
I'll take that all day. Yeah. Take that all day.
We didn't have much of the run game, so looks like maybe they're going to take the old Texas Tech approach when Mike Leach was there and make the run game the pass game and just have a bunch of receivers out there getting open and let Chance sit back there in the pocket and find them.
Acord in shotgun again. This time he's going to hand it off. This one to Jake Branson. He'll get to the line of scrimmage, and that's it. Drew, at halftime, if you're Coach Shaq and the bunch, you're up a score. You had a nice response. What's the game plan, do you think, from his perspective?
I think his perspective, like Chris talked about, I think we'll probably see him run the ball a little more in the second half.
Don't unplug it. If you unplug it, we're
– No, it's not unplugged, but it wasn't registering on here, so I'm not sure what happened.
Acord back to pass screen on the tunnel to Max Brown to cut it back outside, trying to find a block, fumbles it. That'll be loose, and that'll be a Woodward turnover or fumble recovery as Max Brown tries to cut it outside. It looked like it was Kai Gilbert trying to block Jaden Talon Laird, and it'll be just almost the opposite, the flip of the first half, where first possession for the Wildcats ends up being a turnover, and it'll be first and 10 in Wildcat territory for the Boomers.
Yeah, and that time Max was just that was kind of a screen supposed to go inside. The Boomer defensive backs were there to have to turn him back outside. He had room to get out to that edge, but give credit to the defensive back on that side, even with a blocker in his face, he was able to strip that ball out of Max, and it went to Roland. And then the Boomer linebacker was able to jump on it before it went out of bounds.
The Wildcats giving it back up, back on defense. Five-man front this time. Come back up behind the line. Preston Cotter gets the first lick. Camden Maroney, and it looks like Kai Gilbert, Seth Gilbert there. The runner there was number 2, the freshman. We've talked about him, Ace Long, and that'll be a gain of about 1, long 2 here, and they'll bring up 2nd and long.
Yeah, I went back to look. That was number 1, Laird, that was able to strip that out of Max Brown's hands. So he is you see him right there on the offensive side of the ball, but he is a player on the defense that's going to make a difference, and he gave the Boomers back the ball in great field position.
So clock running 10:15 here, third quarter from the 45 on the Cashion side. Power look here under center is Douglas. He's going to hand it off to Long. He's got a nice hole still on his feet. Eventually brought down, dragged down is Jake Branson, and that'll be enough for a first down.
Yeah, and that time.
Go on it. Is it? Okay, yeah.
All right, we got Drew's mic set. Appreciate you guys joining us here on Cashion Wildcat TV. Second half action here live from Maxon Field, 9:45 running clock. First and 10 here from the 34-yard line. Under center is Douglas, the sophomore quarterback who got hot there in the second quarter. He's going to toss Weeb. In pursuit is Maroney. No hold call. Whoa. Coming back through is Gilbert. He'll get the tackle out of bounds. And you know, it's a tough situation. Looked like Camden Roney was slowed down. Get a credit to the
What it looked like to me was Cam was there to kind of turn him back inside, and I think he took that blocker on thinking he would still turn him inside, and he didn't do it. He just bounced it right around him right there. I think Cam, all he needed to do right there was keep continuing up the field, turn it back into that teeth of that defense, and that didn't happen, so he was able to get on around the edge and pick up big yardage on first down.
So gain of 9 for Long. Again, same formation here. Power look under center is Douglas, the sophomore quarterback. He's going to go ahead and hand it off in the backfield. Jackson Vandruff, give credit to Branson, who blew that up from the beginning, brought him right in. He talked about teeth of the defense. Timmy Jones, Preston Cotter. That's a big-time TFL, and I'll bring up 3rd and short here for the Boomers.
Yeah, that time you talked about it on that play before, having Camden there turning it back inside. Jake came in on that little outside blitz there and was able to turn that running back right into the hands of
the usual suspects.
Yeah, Jackson Vandruff was there to meet him, and then you had the whole team coming there to clean him up. Now it's a big third down play here.
Four down territory for the Boomers under center Douglas. He's going to go back to pass, looking for Limits, coming back through. He makes the catch. You're going to call that a completion as number 14 on the skinny post. Mason Boring, the sophomore, 6'2", 160. And that was basically a play to say, look, this is four down territory. We're going to throw one up and see what happens. And then give credit to the offense. And
he kind of double clutched that. He just caught it, though. I thought it bounced up off the ground, but I think he just kind of double clutched, like I said, and then was able to bring it in and secure it.
So moving is the Boomers. They're methodically moving it down to about the 17-18. It'll be first and 10. Power look here, handoff inside. Patient run there by Long. He's going to break through, and it's going to be first and goal for the Boomers.
Yeah, that time Jake was in great position to come in and fill that hole. He wasn't able to bring him down. The running back did a good job of just breaking Jake's tackle and went for the big run on first down. Got him all the way down to about the 3 or 4 yard line.
So first and goal for the Boomers. 7:16 here, third quarter. That's about a 4-minute drive thus far. Same formation, no reason to change it. Douglas under center, going to hand it off to Long. He stays patient. That's a touchdown, 4-yard touchdown for the Boomers. And they're going to cut it to a 1-point lead for the Wildcats.
The Boomer front line is just doing a great job of creating space. And the running backs and the quarterback for the Boomers are just doing a good job of sitting back there, being patient, finding the opening, and then just taking advantage.
And just hitting them.
And right there was a big hole right in the middle for the running back to just scamper right into the end zone to have a chance to tie this up, and they do.
So just like what happened in the first quarter, the Wildcats were beneficiaries of a fumble. They turned that into a score. Well, here, just flip the script. Wildcats turn it over. And that, look, you know what? Wildcats have to play as close to perfect. They can't give the ball up. They can't do that and expect to win. And last week, that was the situation. Had two key turnovers that ended up being significant. And that's the same case here where we could have extended this to a 2-score lead. Now it's a tie ball game.
Yep, and the Boomers came out, like you said, it was almost flipped the script. They gave the ball to Cashion Wildcats. Cashion Wildcats just drove down. Same end zone. It's almost eerily similar. And now the Cashion Wildcats have to come out, respond better than the Boomers did. When the Boomers got the ball back in on that first quarter, they turned it over on an interception. Cashion Wildcats need to get it in their hands, go down here and score and establish that lead back to be able to really get a hold of this ball game, and don't let that momentum really switch over to the Boomers, because if that happens and they get that running game going, that's when real big trouble happens.
Yeah, you're going to run into a lot of problems with the clock in the end of there.
So the Wildcats back in kickoff return formation. Max Brown, Seth Gilbert deep right around the 12-yard line. This one's an angled kick. Brown's going to come up and catch it in the air wisely.
Get over here behind.
He's got a chance to get a lane. He does. Gets to the 35, cuts to the outside. He'll be pushed forward right around the 38, 39-yard line. So nice return there for the Wildcats. They take over for their second possession here in the second half. And, you know, we talk about momentum, but you can just see, you know, this Woodward team is 0-7, but they've been competitive. And they've actually, if you look at film, they've actually killed themselves in a lot of games. They've been competitive. And this is definitely a situation where, you know, we've got to get momentum back.
Yeah, because you start letting these guys have a little success and tasting that, it can snowball really fast. And you want to be able to keep your foot on their throat. And right there, talk about a foot on the throat. That's putting the foot on the throat of the Cashion Wildcats, backing them up about 12 yards on the loss, maybe 11.
Yeah, Chance had Cooper Frazee wide open. He saw him. I don't know why he didn't pull the trigger. Maybe he thought, you know, there was something out there, but he could have kept that short. There was no safety over the top. So the tough situation, takes the sack. Big loss. 10-yard loss brings up second and 20. Wildcats, a little mini avalanche going in the wrong direction. Back to pass, Acord. Looking at Max Brown. He's going to try to hit the pump. Going to come up, stays free. It's going to be a short gain of one.
And I'll bring up third down and long as the Wildcats were running Brown, Frazee, and Gilbert down the sidelines.
That time, if he would have thrown it, I think he had Camden Maroney about 5 or 6 yards down the field, and I saw that line judge was just eyeing him, waiting for him to throw that ball, and he was going to throw the illegal man downfield if that would have happened.
All right, so the short gain, second and third and 19 here for the Wildcats. Need a big play. Pressure's on. Acord will step up, and that'll be a sack.
Yeah, we're just giving him a little time. The only thing is, those plays, when it's that far back behind the chains, it takes time for some of those routes to open up. And we are not giving Chance enough time to really step up in that pocket and make a throw down the field to those routes that take forever to open up. And whenever they're in his face like that, there's nothing else he can do besides go down there.
So Wildcats punt, first possession. Or fumble on their first possession punt here. And this one will go down into Boomer territory right around the 43. And, you know, we get to be, armchair quarterbacks up here. That's one of our gifts. And, you know, those second and long plays, I absolutely love, you know, throwing out a little screen, something simple, draw, trying to, you know, maybe catch them in a situation where maybe you can get half of that back.
Yeah, I mean, you were kind of right on the money, Chris, right there. It just it felt like those routes were just taking too long to develop, and it was just the adverse effect is the defensive line just had enough time to get back there and really, really disrupt the whole play.
Yeah, and I thought, like you said it, Neiman, like, that looks like a screen on that second down play, and it just never came together. And I don't know if that's what it was, or I couldn't really figure out it. Before he had a chance to do much of anything, he was scrambling for his life.
Inside handoff, that time he's met, nowhere to go. Preston Cotter on the tackle, short gain. Good job there by the senior. And coming up slow is the freshman, Ace Long. He's been their man. He's been the guy. I know Laird's had a couple big plays, but it's been the running of Ace Long that has kept Woodward in this game.
Yeah, and you got a backfield for the Boomers, a freshman and a sophomore. And you can kind of look at their schedule and see their they don't have a win, but like you said, they've been competitive in a lot of those ball games and kind of shot themselves in the foot, and that comes with youth. So
you're right.
The Boomers have a bright future with both of those guys in the backfield. They've been making plays for them against the Cashion Wildcats.
Great job with Branson on the outside, taking on the pulling guard, coming in the hole. Matthew Stockton and Timmy Jones and Preston Cotter. And that's a nice tackle there to keep it third and long. Let's see if the Wildcats can hold them and get the ball back here.
Yeah, big play right here. You hold them. Don't let them get close to that first down marker. They're going to punt the ball. You let them get up there, you know, where it's fourth and one, fourth and two. There's a good chance that they're going to try to go for it with the success they've seen on the run in the run game.
10 seconds on the play clock. 3:44 here on the game clock here. Again, shotgun formation for Douglas. Back to pass. Pressure's on. Pass is up high, intended for number 11. He was open, Lucas Shirky, on that post play. They've run that to succession, but that one falls incomplete, a little bit high. Wildcats are able to get the stop and a very crucial punt here in the third quarter.
I guess the coaching staff of the Boomers decided it was either get the first down or we're punting either way. I would have, you know, if I'm the Boomer fan, I'm thinking, let's run the ball. We've been getting 4 or 5 yards a pop, if not more. Let's give ourselves a shot with two plays instead of one. They decided to throw the ball, but they've had success doing that,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, they have.
So can't blame them there. Good job for the Cashion Wildcats to get the ball back in their hands.
But right goes right to Gilbert. I think he could have caught that one. He lets that one go. Wildcats lose about 10 yards on that bounce, and so it'll be first and 10 right around the 12. But the defense bows up, gets the stop.
Yep.
Great stops on first and second down, basically holding them to about 3 or 4 yards.
Kind of forcing their hand there.
Yep.
And we talked about it. I said it before that play, that drive started that we scored on right before half. Is first down is huge for the Cashion Wildcats this year. It seems like how we go on first down is how we go on the drive. So every first down play is big time for the Cashion Wildcats. Let's see what they pull out here. And that's not good.
So on the zone read, on the big sack, and it's give credit that time to number 44. That's Lewis Corral. We called his name, senior, 5'11", 5'11", 215 linebacker.
I think that was number 42 or 42.
Oh,
yeah, 42. 42. Came inside.
Another senior. Yeah, 5'8", 220. So big loss. Wildcats going backwards here the last couple of possessions, including the first, the last three here in the opening the second half with that fumble.
They've got little man on Max Brown out there that cannot stay with him. Throw it deep to him. Let him get another big time touchdown here.
And that's what they're going to look for.
Oh, my God. Oh. It's going to be a
And that will be a safety.
Safety, yeah. He has no time. Like, there's
no time. We've been getting killed on the edge.
Just do a two-step drop and throw it deep. I don't know what's going on with our front line, but they are not protecting the quarterback right now. And it is just backing up and backing up all the way to a safety there. And that is not a good look for the Cashion Wildcats. The Cashion Wildcats are going to throw their defense back out here and put them in a bad position. Because where do you kick off? You kick off from the 20-yard line on the free kick after a safety. So the Boomers are going to not only get the 2 points from the safety, but they're going to have good field position here after this free kick. Let's hope the Cashion Wildcat defense gets another stop. And then you've got to have Coach Robertson and the crew over there get over there with that line and say, what's going on? What are you seeing? Let's learn from that and shore that up to give Chance any kind of time to make a play
down
the field.
You know, Chris, look, you called it, right? You had the matchup you want. The play, though, you want to run is that slant, right?
Yeah.
Or a dig. I mean, he was out on the – he was on the numbers. We were on the opposite hash. He had plenty of space. They called the long pass. I like the call as well. I'm just saying in the situation, you're right, with the pressure that they were getting, a quick
catch and throw.
Quick snap, go, see what you got. And, in that situation, Max Brown's got the speed. He gets by that one guy, he's gone. And that might be another, another house call, another 90-yard house call in Max Brown's favor. So it's a safety. It's the first lead by the Boomers. They've scored 9 unanswered here in the second half. Wildcats getting the ball, go fumble, punt, and safety. And they'll be kicking off as the Boomers are going to have really good field position, and it'll be back on the hands or the shoulders of the defense to get it going back again. Chandler with the kick, 2:34 here in the third quarter. And he's going to kick out of bounds.
So they'll get the ball. I think it went out of bounds about the 47-yard line. So it will be Boomer ball on the Cashion Wildcats side of the field.
No, it'll be on the Boomer side. But, yeah, it's still the 47.
Well, they're out of bounds, right?
They're going to make him re-kick. So Coach Coach Lugin, he rolled the dice last time. It did not work.
Well, I'll try it again.
He's going to try it again.
Because if they would have left it there, the ball went out right there where he was at about the 48-yard line. It would have been a 5-yard penalty on top of that. And so it would have been about the Cashion 46-yard line, somewhere 47-yard line.
They aren't going to take it. So that's the wise move, right? So, I mean, you get the ball at midfield, you take them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You don't risk a fumble.
Yeah, you don't want to.
A penalty, a block in the back.
Yeah, so it will be a 47-yard line. Yeah, Cashion 47-yard line.
Okay. So with that, another fantastic field position for the Boomers. They got it on the Cashion 47 on their first possession, got a touchdown. They got it on their own 44, had to punt. They've been celebrating fantastic field position this whole second half. So with 2:34, Wildcats now down 2 points against the 4A Boomers.
Like I said, you start giving these kids a little taste of success, and they're going to start playing with more confidence. And you're going to have trouble coming back in this ball game, because if they can start running that ball, controlling clock with the lead, it's going to be a tough tour for the Cashion Wildcats.
I mean, you got to have a four and out situation right here.
I'm not sure what they're.
Well, at least they're talking it over before the play occurred. So. And we do appreciate that. We did have this crew against Western Heights, so you were right, Chris.
No, I think Drew said that.
Drew said that. Thank you, Drew. All right, so it's at the 45 now. So,
which I don't understand that, because the ball was at whichever way. I mean, I thought it's a 5-yard penalty from where it went out of bounds, and they marked it off right, but they moved it up to the 45-yard line of Cashion.
Ace Long on the Wildcat, tackled by Preston Cotter. He'll get a 2 or 3 on that one. That'll bring up second down and about a long 7.
Cashion Wildcat defense, that last possession was great. They stopped them on and made it, you know, third and long. Put them in a position they had to pass the ball down the field. And right here, kind of setting up for that again. Preston did a good job coming in and making that tackle. Let's see if they continue to try to run the ball on first and second down just to kind of run that clock, or if they're going to try to air it out. We saw it. They've kind of done both. You know, they ran the ball a whole lot that one possession pretty much all the way down the field, and then they aired it out the other.
Toss there. Actually, keeper there to the left side there is the freshman Ace Long. He gets it to the 40-yard line, so it'll be a third down and five. Definitely four-down territory here for the Boomers.
Yeah, no doubt, and that's why I'm figuring they'll just continue to run the ball, keep it in bounds, and try to pick up first downs. It's already down to a minute and 30 seconds of the third quarter, so if they keep the ball in their hands, keeps it out of the hands of the Wildcats. Right now, though, putting the ball in the hands of the Wildcats was in favor.
It's not really doing us any favors.
But you keep it out of their hands. You drive down and put another touchdown on the board. That's two possession. Get a field goal. That's two possession ball game. And
handoff inside. He's going to get across the first down. So give credit to number 18, Jeremy Bencomo, the freshman. Chains move. Clock moves. It'll be a Wildcat a Boomer first down. So under a minute here, running clock, third quarter. First and 10 from the 30. Boomers will go back. Wildcats certainly trying to regroup here, staying in that four-man front. And really, it's nothing sophisticated. You know, they're basically running. You know, basically Wildcat keepers, you know, student body lefts and right. Sometimes a handoff up the middle, and then it's a quick slant or a post when needed a pass.
Yeah, and they're just really kind of have our front line on their heels. And when you do that and they're blowing you off the ball and you get some momentum going downhill, they're picking up big yardage every time they touch the ball and keep it on the ground.
So with that timeout, the play clock was down to zero. So Coach Rick Luchin with the timeout. So first and 10, we'll take a timeout ourselves. We'll be right back, CWTV.
At Maples Nixon Diesel Horse, we've helped a lot of people. And our goal was to treat each and every person like a friend. And as a friend, we've got your back always. We understand what you're going through. Being lawyers is what we do, but it's not all that we are. We care. We'll stand beside you throughout the entire legal process, not just as lawyers, but as your friends. We are Maples Nixon Diesel Horst, and we are here to help.
High school streaming service, Skordle.tv. Find out more at Skordle.com/stream.
All right, welcome back. CWTV production here of Cashion Wildcat Football 2022. Nima, Chris, and Drew bringing tonight's action. Third quarter, 22 seconds. Wildcats find themselves down two now as the Boomers are driving now after their safety to take the lead. First and 10 from the 30-yard line on the Cashion side. They've been working that run game. It's like a little reverse here to Lewis. The Wildcats are ready, coming up in outside. Cooper Frazee trying to get the angle, cutting back. Max Brown trying to bring him down. He finally goes down as Cooper Frazee comes back. We do have a flag back at the 30-yard line. Not sure if we're going to have a legal procedure or not.
I think it's going to be a legal procedure. They threw it as the ball was snapped. So I'm thinking they didn't have enough on the line or
– yeah, false start.
Yep. Illegal.
So Wildcats extremely fortunate. They were ready for it this time, but poor tackling, terrible angles, and terrific individual effort there by Taylen Laird, the senior, 6'3", 175 senior for the Boomers. And so that'll march it back. It'll be first and 15.
Chris, can you turn my mic down a little bit?
Yeah. And that right here, this is given a little hot. Turn you down a little bit. Right here, Cashion Wildcats have to take advantage of this, you know, kind of them shooting themselves in the foot here, because we've had this position before, you know, in the last half where they kind of got backed up and then they were able to hit some big passes down the field. We know that they're probably going to throw the ball. We've seen it happen with them backed up like this. defensively, you got to get after that quarterback, make him throw one up, and go pick one off. Get a turnover and be able to put the ball back in the Cashion Wildcats' hands to be able to go down the field, get the lead back in this ball game.
All right, so that's the end of the third quarter there as the Boomers, with that last penalty and the runoff of the clock, they were able to get it from the Cashion 45-yard line. They've got a first down with 2:34, so we're still with the ball. We'll put a fresh 12 on here, fourth quarter. Still a one-possession game. Wildcats get a stop, go down and get a score. You know, the things can look better, but it has to start here with Tony Wood and his defense, as the Boomers have been slashing them and gashing them with runs and reverses all night.
Well, and the thing is, I mean, even if they score here, the ball game's not over. We've seen the Cashion Wildcats in that first quarter score two really quick touchdowns.
Yep.
So the thing is, even if they get in this end zone, you're still only down 9 points. You get one stop in the ball, go score. You get one stop in the ball game, and you have a chance to go win this ball game. So the Cashion Wildcats just have to get out there, play hard, play their game, come downhill, be physical, and give yourself a chance to win this ball game.
All right. So with that, the start of the fourth quarter, 12 minutes on the clock. Wildcats down 2, 23-21. Appreciate you guys joining us here on CashionWildcats.tv, CWTV, powered by Squirtle. Power look here in shotgun now. Wildcat look, movement, no call. Back there's Jackson Vandruff.
There we go.
That's a big TFL. That'll bring up second down and long. Way to go, Mr. Jackson.
Yeah, that time nobody blocked Jackson. He was able to just come free off the edge and was able to get to the quarterback before he could really even make a step forward. And so this really puts him behind the chains now. Second in double sticks, looks like. And so the Cashion Wildcat defensive backs, be ready. It's coming. They're going to throw the ball. Put some pressure on that quarterback and go get an interception.
All right, so it's Ace Long, the freshman in the backfield. Jeremy Bencomo in pistol formation with him. He's going to go ahead and hand it to Bencomo. He's going to get to the outside. He's got a huge lane. He's going to come up, try to cut back through. He'll get tackled. Good job by Cooper Frazee.
I think he went down. He started going down there just to stay in bounds to keep the clock running. But he went down before the first down marker.
It almost looked like our secondary there for a second was kind of looking towards this closer side here at number one, who was lined up out there kind of by Max.
So good job there by Bencomo. Again, the freshman, 5'8", 135, running back showing his skills. So that brings up third and four down territory. Clock stops for some reason with 11-11 on the clock. I'm not sure.
I guess he did go out of bounds, but the way they marked it there, I thought they kept the clock running.
Long will keep it. He'll have enough for the first down, and he's going to have enough for the touchdown. So a 23-yard touchdown run by Ace Long, and the Boomers have extended their lead to 8.
Yeah, that time he just run right up the middle between the tackles. And the Cashion Wildcat defense is just getting blown off the ball. There's the Boomer offensive line is just creating huge holes in space. And he was able to just bounce it out to the outside there and find a room to run all the way to the end zone.
Let me tell you, I'm not going to try to make excuses for the Wildcats here, but when you have 11 guys playing two ways in a Class A team, and you've got a 4A school, high school with 70 guys out there, and they can stay fresh, and your linemen aren't playing both ways. This is where it comes back, and it might get you in the second half, and that's what we've seen here in the fourth quarter.
Yeah, and I don't think you're making excuses. It's just a matter of the fact that whenever you have a chance to rest in between possessions, when you're on, you only play offense, and the Cashion Wildcats were in that position the last probably not as much last year, but 2 years ago and 3 years ago, where they had that luxury of being able to, let the front line on offense and defense. I think there might have been one kid that really played back and forth. And when you have that luxury in a Class A school, you're at a huge advantage. The Boomers are a 4A school. They have that.
We're 5A last year.
They were 5A last year. They have that, and that's, every team that they see has that advantage.
Yeah.
And so out here tonight, you're just kind of seeing what happens when a team gets winded. But I still have plenty of faith in these Cashion Wildcats and the heart that they have, and they're going to give everything they've got to get back in this ball game and try to come back and win this thing here in the fourth quarter.
All right, so kicking off will be the Boomers high onside. They're going to let that one bounce. It's going to hit the ground. Brown with the catch, cuts back outside, hangs on, and he'll go down, and it's a good kick, good coverage there by the Boomers, and just a very short return.
And I think here's what I want to see on the offensive side of the football. The Boomers, all they're doing is they're bringing as much pressure as they can, and we just don't have enough time to throw the ball. With them bringing that much pressure, can you find a run play or something that you can kind of find the hole where they're not at and be able to get a run, big run, or you're going to have to just do some quick throws, quick slants to get the ball out of Chance's hand.
Acord back to pass. He's going to come back to the out to Cooper Frazee. He's going to catch it, trying to break free. He does. He was knocked down.
Yeah, as he turned there, the official thought his knee was down, but just from the angle I had, didn't look like he was down there. He just broke the tackle, and he was off to the races there. But the official blows the whistle, blows it dead with us only getting about 3 yards on the play.
Second and seven, 10:33 running clock here. Good job by Frazee, wiggling free. Acord back to pass, pumps.
Oh.
Just another sack. I mean, that's all there is to it right there. As he was being able to step up to make a throw, the line of the defensive line of the Boomers are just eating up the Cashion Wildcat front right now. And it's not pretty look for the Cashion Wildcats. Chance Acord is doing all he can. And that time, all he could do was protect the ball and make sure he didn't fumble.
Third and 15, 9:56, empty back. Empty set here for the Wildcats. They go trips up top with Gilbert and Higdon. Down below is Frazee and Brown here on the short side. Four-man rush, five-man rush. Across the middle. Great catch and toss, and that's exactly what Acord needs to do. He needs to pull the trigger and hit his man. At that time, it's Seth Gilbert with a huge catch and a first down across midfield.
Yeah, Chance has just got to trust himself right there. I went back and looked at the play where we had the sack. He had time to step up and throw that first initial throw,
it just looked like
and that time he did it.
Empty set again here for the Wildcats at the Boomer 49, 9:20 on the clock. Wildcats looking to try to get a score to cut into this nine-point lead. 9 seconds on the play clock. Back to pass, Acord. Pressure's on. Coming back to Brown. Ooh. He catches, concentrates, gets it forward, and that's all we need. It's okay. He doesn't need to get a touchdown on one play. Well, you will take it, but that's a nice 6-7 yard gain here for Brown. Wildcats going in hurry up here as the Boomers are trying to get back in position. Again, empty set here. Acord will snap. Pressure on. Coming back tunnel to Brown. Puts on the Jets. Gets to the outside. That's a first down, and we'll take that all day.
All day.
You had Jackson Vanderf out there blocking in front of him, and he completely destroyed the defensive back that was trying to get up there and make the play after the Max Brown had caught that screen play. And a good job by the Wildcats to get down the field.
Back to Brown after that big catch to Gilbert, back to pass, looking to the tunnel, the fake. Cooper Frazee out there on the double move. Uh-oh. Letting it go. He's got a wide open man. Gilbert with the catch. Down to the one. Is it a touchdown?
Yep, they are going to say it's down at the
down
one.
Down to one. Great job as Acord works his magic in the pocket. Lets it fly. Finds Gilbert running free down the hash. And it's first and goal for the Wildcats. Running clock here, 8:30 here after the ball is set, double back. It's like a single back set with Cooper Frazee, double tight end here with Gilbert and Higdon. Snap, hand off to Frazee, cuts it back in. Is he in? Touchdown, Cashion Wildcats!
Exactly what the Cashion Wildcats needed right there. You know, you had the long pass play to Gilbert. It was kind of set up by, like you said, Chance Acord just stepping up in the pocket. You had Preston Cotter fighting to get to a block to kind of spring Acord enough for him to just float it out there to Seth Gilbert, and he caught it right there on the one-yard line. Cooper Frazee takes the fake handoff. Chance pulls it out and goes in for the Cashion Wildcat touchdown, and then we don't get the extra point. Was that the bad snap? Is that what it was? I was looking down trying to find the replay, and I missed it.
Yeah, so I was going to try to double jinx us, saying, well, it's an important extra point here, but I don't think Cashion's in a position to try to hit a field goal.
You've got to score another touchdown either way.
That's exactly right. So the extra point is not as good. The safety looms big here as the Boomers are up 30-27. Wildcats will be kicking off. But, again, a fantastic series for the Wildcats to answer as they go 71 yards. It covers, again, the distance there, about a minute and a half off the clock, almost 2 minutes, 1 yard touchdown, highlighted by big plays to Seth Gilbert, both on the big play across the middle, and then another one.
Here's the replay right here. You see Preston Cotter come up here and get a good block, and then just he floats it out there to Seth. He's able to catch it and get him all the way down to the 1 yard line.
Looked like
as close to a hold there.
Yes, I agree.
We're fortunate that they did not call that a hold, really. Heck, we caught a break. Yep. What's that look like? I mean, we hadn't caught one of those in a while.
Hey, even Steven on the series as Cooper Frazee was not down, but we'll there certainly take it. And, hey, Wildcats respond. You talked about it. Keep the faith. So let's hear what Chandler Christensen does, kicking off from the 40. Let's see if he can keep it in bounds this time. Number 13, it looks like Carson Medina is going to be the intended receiver. He will. It's going to go deep middle. Caught by Medina at the 10. Jake Branson right there will have a flag as Jackson Vandruff is literally tackled.
Just taken down there, and it will be a flag. So it will be – is that from the end of the run?
I believe it is from the – I don't know if it's from the spot. Let's see if he lays his flag down. He picks it up. So it will be from the end of the run. So that's a big stop. So the return goes all the way out, it looks like, to right around the 30-yard line. Coach Shackelford's asking if it's from the spot or at the end of the run. They're going to wave it.
So they didn't even call the flag? Jackson Vandruff was literally tackled down to the ground. And I don't know if he's calling it was he going to call it a block in the back?
Nonetheless, it's first and 10 from the 29. Wildcats need to stop here. So if you're Coach Wooden a bunch, do you bring pressure?
I thought it worked out really well for us when we were bringing pressure with like Camden and not Camden Jackson, but Camden, those other secondary guys.
First and 10 here. It's going to be that Wildcat look here for the Boomers. Freshman gets it. Up the middle, nowhere to go. He'll get a couple yards there as he falls forward, maybe one or two. Good job there on first down as Matthew Stockton and Tommy Branson in on the tackle. Good work there by the interior lineman.
Yeah, bring it right here, boys. This is it. I mean, you let them drive the field right here. You don't give yourself much of a chance to have enough time to come back if you go down two possessions here. So this is the ball game. This drive right here is the ball game. We get a stop right here. You give yourself a chance to win the ball game. You don't, and it's pretty much over. So Cashion Wildcats are going to take this chance right here. Looks like there is a injury or a little cramp over there for the Boomers. Take this time right here for Coach Wood to get them over to the sideline and say, here it is, boys. You know what you got to do. You got to get this stop. Let's game plan this and get out there and execute and get the ball back in the hands of our offense.
So we've seen this all season. You Rejoice Christian wanting a little revenge, Pahuska wanting revenge, Minko wanting revenge, right? We've seen this. We also saw that with Christian Heritage, right? So they're coming out. Coach Shackelford talked about it, Wildcats being everyone's Super Bowl. And here's a team that's 4A, right, that's 0-7. This is literally their Super Bowl. This is their chance, right? We're grateful that they came down here. Don't get me wrong.
Yeah, absolutely.
Super grateful.
It's not like they don't have any revenge against us. They're just
– They're looking for their first win.
Here's an opportunity to go play the reigning champions in 1A and get our first win and get it in the win column. And so they're fighting for their life here.
Inside handoff to Combe. Breaks free. Gets to the second level. And Wildcats have no answer for Jeremy Bencomo, the freshman. It's not like he's flashing any extra speed. He's just doing a great job of picking a spot, finding the hole, being patient.
Yeah, that's what I was about to say. They're just being patient. They're finding their front line is really creating some holes. They're being patient, finding space, and then they're just going downhill.
Wildcats giving up the first down there. So first and 10, clock running, 7:24. So you talked about clock is our enemy right now for the Wildcats. We got to get a stop here for sure. So, again, first and 10 from the 43. Again, that same formation. It's going to be longer Bencomo running the ball. This time it's long. Cuts back up. Staying patient. It's going to be another first down, this time into Cashion territory.
Now, looking back, if we would have gone for two, we'd have been down by one.
Yeah.
They go down and score, kick a field goal. We're only down by eight.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm looking back. Yeah. I almost wish we would have gone for two there. Yeah. Give yourself an opportunity to only be down one, even if they scored.
So I'm of the favor. You only go for two when you have to, but I get what you're saying. You know, here's a situation. I don't think Ace Long's
going to – that we don't kick field goals at all.
Well, Ace Long's not throwing the ball. I don't know why we're not selling out here to stop the run.
Yeah.
I mean, we've got linebackers that are 7 yards off the ball. Long will keep it. He's got a huge hole, got a convoy. He's going to break free in the second level. Finally brought down by Cooper Frazee.
I'm with you, Nima. That when we were doing in the second quarter there, and we just had that pressure of Camden and those linebackers, and they were walked up or blitzing. It was
fill the gap.
It was really killing their momentum.
Yeah, fill the gap, move them up, really put them in a position to have to throw the ball.
Have we seen Ace Long throw a ball? Are they going to let him throw a ball? I don't think so.
Not in the second half. He threw one pass play in the second half, and it fell to the ground.
I'll risk it. Risk it at this point. I'd put six men on the line, try to make them figure out and dare them to throw one up to the Taylen Laird kid or the Lucas Shirey kid. Give me a handoff. Fumble. The chance. Did we get it?
Nope. One of their linemen turned around right there, saw it on the ground, fell on
it. Goodness, that was going to be a Wildcat opportunity. So clock still runs, 5:38. I don't know if it's be a chance here. The Wildcats might have to burn a timeout. Again, second and long here. That was a big break for the Wildcats. Again, we've got guys that are 7 yards off the line.
Yeah, still haven't really moved anybody else extra up in that box. This time they're moving Kai up a little bit into that box, but you still got your linebackers 7 yards off the ball. You want them up in those gaps where you can't really have anything easy.
Outside run. Give credit to Maroney turning him up inside. It looks like it was Gilbert on the tackle. Gain of about 4 or 5. That brings up third and long. So with 4:48 running clock, Shackelford's going to hang on to his timeouts.
Yeah, I don't think he's going to call a timeout really until he gets down there below that 3-minute mark. And they still have the ball. You might see a timeout just because it's time to really bring the boys over and get them a breather and have to get a stop. But, man, right here, this is a big down. Get them in third and long here. You get a big stop here behind the line of scrimmage. Put them in fourth and long. Make them pass the ball. You have a chance.
Bencomo with a cutback outside. Wildcats in pursuit. Big tackle. There's this tackle. We
exactly
get a timeout.
What you need.
We get a timeout here. So big tackle for loss. That'll bring up fourth down. So with 4 minutes running clock here, decision time. Is it punt time or do they go for it? And actually it looked like it'll be a timeout for Coach Luton and the Boomers.
No, he didn't call timeout.
Oh, I thought he signaled timeout. Looked like he had his hands together.
Big play right here, boys. If you can get a stop here, get the ball back in the hands of the Wildcats, you have a great opportunity to drive the field, win the ball game. But
I'm telling you, they run the clock down, the play clock down to
they're
zero.
They're going to call a timeout.
Yep. Yep.
Yeah, and to your credit, Nima, you said call a timeout here. You call a timeout, that saves 40 seconds. They're going to call a timeout either way. But at the same time, you get the ball, you get the stop here. You have all three timeouts with about 3 minutes left on the clock, and that's plenty of time for the Cashion Wildcats to drive down the field and get the go-ahead score.
So the Boomers got the ball at their own 29 with 8:11 on the clock. It's been a 5-minute drive here, working it down to the Cashion side of the 27. So let's see. I'm gonna believe. You know, do they punt it and try to pin us and make us go deep, go 90 yards, or do they just go ahead and try to run
a play? I mean, after
the
success they had on the last couple times we've been trying to have them to sit back there and, you know, wait on chance, have time to throw the ball. I mean, that doesn't look too bad from Coach Lugit's situation, I think.
Well, the thing is, I mean, you're at the – what are they at? 27. The 27-yard line. If you punt it and it actually goes through the end zone, then they're back at the 20 anyway. Yeah. You might as well go for it here on fourth down. Try to get the pick up the first – And if you don't, you have them backed up. Yep. I mean, you're already there. So they're gonna go for this ball, right here. Only thing is, what I'm wondering is if are they gonna try to throw the ball and pick it up?
I'm jet
or run it?
Now, jet sweep or reverse, one or the other.
Yep. I mean, if you can run the ball, keep it in bounce.
Yeah.
Run more off the clock. If you throw it, clock stops, and you have the Cashion Wildcats have the ball with about 3 minutes, 15 seconds left, really the chance to go down the score.
So trips left look here.
Big play. Let's go.
Yep. Wildcats. They bring out their passer, Ryan Douglas, the quarterback, who's been sitting on the bench. Back to pass, looking for the pump. Vandruff in his face. Passes up.
Are you kidding me? Just floats it up there, kind of a back shoulder throw. Both defensive backs just run right by the receiver, and the receiver's able to come back and just wait for the ball to come to the ground. And he catches it for the first down, and you've got a huge problem here for the Wildcats. If they go in and score, you just don't have time to really get the ball back and get in the end zone. Two times with only 3 minutes left. They're going to run the ball, and they're running the clock down right now. So it'll be – they won't snap this ball until under 3 minutes.
So first and 10 from the – first and goal from the 9. Keep is long. He's going to go up, and that's going to be a touchdown.
Yep, it will be a touchdown, and ran right up the gut. You know, it was just kind of you get them to that fourth and long, and you have the opportunity to stop them, get the ball back in your offensive hands, and go win the ball game, and then you just don't capitalize on just a floater out there to the receiver, and just took the complete win, every bit of win that you had in the sails of the Cashion Wildcats just out, and they were able just to run the ball right up the middle. But honestly, if they're going to score, it would be better on that play right there quickly than to have a chance to run down the clock even more. But we did have the timeouts. If you could get some stops and get them, don't let them score there. Use your timeouts. Maybe have a minute left on the ball in the ball game to go down and score. But they scored quickly. Now the Cashion Wildcats either have to run this back and then get a stop, or they're going to have to quick strike two or three play drive here and get in the end zone to even give themselves a shot to maybe do an onside kick or get the ball back in the hands of. You don't want, if you use any of your timeouts, you use them all. It's pretty much ball game.
All right, so that was a possession that started on their own 29. They went 71 yards in basically about 5 minutes. They get the 9-yard touchdown run there by Ace Long. He's had himself a night tonight. Definitely well over 100 yards easily for him. And Wildcats had their opportunities. I don't know how else to say it. But let's see what happens here. If Wildcats can score fast enough, get a chance maybe with an onside or with the ability to use those timeouts and get the ball back maybe under 30 seconds if they're able to get a three and out. We'll see what happens.
And you said it a while ago, with Ace Long back there getting the snap, you got to bring eight people into the box and stop them. He did not throw one pass. Ryan Douglas goes back to quarterback. First thing he does is throw the ball. So, man, you go back and watch some of this film, and you're probably thinking, man, we could have done some things different. But it's a lot easier up here than it is down there on the field.
So high onside, the Wildcats were very fortunate to get that. Give credit to the freshman Westerhoff on the recovery. And I really don't understand that.
No, I don't either.
I mean, you give Cashion the ball at the 41.
Yeah, great field position and don't use any clock.
Yeah. No clock. You're putting them on their own 42.
So 2:46 on the clock. Wildcats need two scores. Got to get in here. Empty set here for the Wildcats. It was actually Jumbo here, double tight end, four wide. Looking for the pump and go. He's got Brown wide open. Catches the ball at the 30. He can break one free. He gets the guy to miss to the 25, 15, 10, the 5. He's carrying his man.
Get in the end zone, baby.
And he's out of bounds at the 2-yard line. So if there was ever a best-case scenario for the Wildcats, that was it.
Shaq and T-Wood down there raising all kinds of cane, trying to get everybody lined up real quick.
Yeah, I said it. You got to have a quick strike, either run one back or get down there on one or two plays, and that's exactly what happened right there with the Cashion Wildcats. Now you got to punch it in.
Frazee with a handoff. Gets that's underneath. Touchdown, Cashion Wildcats. Two-play, 59-yard drive. Frazee with another touchdown, his third of the night. The Wildcats getting close. Wow. So Wildcats will kick the extra point.
And right here, you know, with the...
You go for two, you can win with a field goal, just putting it out there. But I guess we'll trust them here with the extra point. Good snap, hold, kick is up, it's good. Great job there by the special teams. And so just like that, two-play drive. It takes about 20, maybe not even 20 seconds. It takes about 15 seconds. Wildcats go 59, and they're within three here against the Boomers.
Yeah, and it all started with them trying to do a little onside pooch kick that took no time off the clock and gave the Wildcats a great, great field, starting field position and gave them a chance to get down there. Quick strike. Touchdown for the Cashion Wildcats. But now what do you do here if you're Cashion Wildcats? Do you kick it off and you have three timeouts left on the board? Do you try to kick it deep and get a stop, or do you take a chance,
Chris,
to
get an onside kick? They're not going to do anything but run the ball. Kick the onside.
Kick the onside, try to get it back in your hands. I mean, that's the best opportunity. If they do get the ball, they're going to run the ball either way. Yep. Yep. So – well, you really want to give your team a chance to try to get that ball on the onside, but they're going to line up and try to get that. The only reason I would say that they might kick it deep is try to get it over the head of one of these guys.
I got you. I'm with you. I'm okay with either one. I'm okay. I'm just letting you know what I'd do. You ask me. Number 10, that is Thomas Fearless, the sophomore, is back there deep for the Boomers. Christensen here on the 40. We got Gilbert, Vandruff. They're going to go for the onside. It's a dribbler. It's loose. And they do touch it right on the inside of the 49. So it'll be Woodward ball, first down and 10. So with 2:33 left, this is it, partner.
Yep.
You know, those onside kicks like that, the little dribbler, you want to get it some, give it some speed. Give it to some speed, because the ball had almost stopped, and it's easy to fall on.
I think he mishit it.
You gotta hit that baby hard, make it bounce off the chest of one of those big boys
down there.
Yep. And but they have the ball. Yeah, you said it. This is it, man. This is ball game. You get a stop right here, a three and out, you have a chance to win this ball game. You don't. It's ball game.
Well, it starts here at first down. Yep. So we won't be taking the timeout here. It'll be on the – unless we get a big loss. So 2:33, first and 10. Boomers in that Wildcat look. They've showed all the time. Maroney blitz up the middle. Finds a lane. Long is free. Oh. Branson, the trackster, chasing him down, and that'll be a touchdown.
Yep, that was it right there. You kind of sell out, bringing everybody up to the line of scrimmage there, and you find a hole, and that's exactly what Long did. And that hole led all the way to the end zone. Nobody, there was people there to make the tackle. Just he broke the tackle of that initial surge of Wildcats.
And then, like you said, most of our guys are already up there, and so it's just kind of relying on some people with a lot of speed.
Yeah, you know, they brought Maroney. It looked like through the A-gap, I would have, you know, every one of these runs have been, you know, B and C. You know, give credit to Long. That one actually squeaks through, so the extra point's good. And so just like that, literally within 30 seconds, we have two scores, and it goes back to a 10-point lead for the Boomers. So Wildcats, 2:23 left. It's,
who knows?
I mean,
get the ball back. Run one back here, and you're back in that same position almost where you have a chance to do an onside kick.
A lot of rinse and repeat of what we did the last possession.
I don't think I think Luchin's going to kick it off deep this time. I don't think he's going to.
Which I don't understand that on that last kick anyway. Why you put us on our own 42?
But. Well, he's thinking let's not let him run one back and get some momentum. But at the same time, you're giving them in a great field position. So. They've done a great job covering all night long, so you're going to see him kick it deep here. Yeah. If I was that coach, I would definitely be kicking deep.
Yeah, in fact, Max, I'd like to see Max and Seth kind of scoot up a little bit more. All the kicks have been high poochers, and so love to see a situation where, that's what they're doing here, so they can catch it on the run as opposed to letting the ball kind of roll around on the ground. Max has gotten a couple of them out of the air. Let's see if he gets this one.
So back to kick is number 11, Lucas Sharkey, the senior, 6 foot, 165. Looks like he's got a left side return, which nobody is there. And they do, they put it out there. Is anybody out there? Nobody's out there. Bulls back, and so Gilbert catches it, thankfully. Takes a knee, though, at the 25. Would have liked for him to be able to run that one back. We had nobody on the left. We could see the kicker kicking it to the left. So with that, it'll be Wildcat football at the 25-yard line.
Which, I mean, glad Seth was there after that bounce. It kind of scared me for a half second.
2:22 on the clock. Wildcat scored with 2:46 on the clock. The Boomer scored with 2:33 on the clock. So now with 2:22, we've had 24 seconds and two scores. Empty set for Acord. Back to pass. He's going to look back to his left. Double pump. He's going to come back up. Cross the middle. He's got Gilbert in and out of his hands. He had a chance at that one. If he would have had a, you know, there would have been some contact there with Carson Medina coming across. But I think if he would have been able to hang on to that, he would have had a chance to get a few more yards.
Yeah, and the way he was going there across the field, he might have had a chance to get out of bounds and stop the clock. That's what it's going to have to be, a big play down the field, touchdown, or something to the edge where you can get out of bounds.
Tip ball, backward pass. They're going to call incomplete. As I said, it was forward, so that negates an opportunity there for Seth Gilbert on the screen. I like the play call. He had the blocking that time with Cooper Frazee, Gilbert, and Maroney out there. Kind of pulling out there to go block from that left tackle position, or left guard, I should say. Definitely four down territory, third and 10, 2:11 on the clock. Wildcats down 10, 44-34. Acord empty set, five-man rush. He's got time. Nope. He's going to keep his feet. He's going to get sacked.
And they're only bringing four people right there, and you got – five blockers and a running back there. You got to give that quarterback plenty of time to find an open man. He had time there right at the beginning to kind of step into the first throw, but when that wasn't open, by the time he kind of regathered himself, he was swallowed up by the Boomer defense.
Clock running, 1:38, fourth and 10. This is it for the Wild. Fourth and 20 for the Wildcats.
Step up.
Acord. And that'll be it with the sack. That'll be a turnover of downs. And the Boomers, 0-7 on the year, will move to 1-7. The Wildcats, with their second straight loss, will move to 3-5. The Wildcats do still have all three timeouts. I guess we'll use them here. Can't take them home.
Yeah, right here, you know, the Cashion Wildcat defense, you want to step up. Don't let them get in the end zone. With us having three timeouts, kind of depends on is you know, if they run the ball down it, are you going to call your timeouts or do you let it go? I mean, you still got time on the clock and three timeouts. I say you go down, fight, and use the timeouts. Don't let them in the end zone. Try to get it back. Go score one long one, try to get an onside kick. I mean, I'm just through in my head as a competitor, you try to figure out any way possible to win. And it just doesn't look good for the Cashion Wildcats. And if you down it here, call a timeout, nope. I guess we're just throwing in the towel, I guess. I mean, it's you're behind, way behind the eight ball.
It's not district play, yeah. So I don't want to maybe risk someone getting injured. So with that, the Wildcats will move to 3-5. They'll fall 34-44. It was all Boomers in the second half. They had one, two, three, four touchdowns and a safety. The Wildcat defense was missing. The Wildcat offense was missing as well in the second half. Some nice opportunities here for the Wildcats. Started off great.
Did we have a stop at all in the second half?
We did. They punted one time.
They did punt.
Yeah,
that
they punted
one
time. Okay. But the second half started eerily with the fumble there by Max Brown on the opening kick. Turned into a touchdown, a punt, a safety,
Came back with a couple of touchdowns and then a turnover of downs. Wildcats again moved to 3-5 on the season. The Boomers with their first victory will celebrate back to what county is that? Cheese County? Latonga County?
A long ways off county.
It is a long ways off. Yeah. The
Boomers. I mean, it's what, about a two-hour drive up there? Yeah.
All right, so we do appreciate you guys joining us. We'll be back live again next week. It'll be a Friday edition, thankfully, as the Wildcats will be on the road in district against Hinton. Goal still in front of them. They have a chance to clean a few things up from this game and get a chance to get a win, a big win over Hinton.
Big win over Hinton, then you got to play a big win over Crescent.
Crescent, senior night at home.
Senior night at home.
Figure out how to keep their playoff hopes alive. So for my man Chris and Drew, we appreciate you guys joining us here on CW-TV. Wildcats fall to 3-5 on the season. Hang tight and watch us through Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. We'll keep you up to speed on what's happened to the Wildcats as they chase an opportunity to get to the playoffs here in 2022. Thank you so much. God bless and go Cats.
Kyle and Gina Van Druff have the answers to all your real estate and insurance needs. These guys will have you covered in a one-stop shopping experience. They are local agents, local supporters.